Yeah, but a death save's not a saving throw.
Are you certain?
Yes.
Can we grab that?
Well, let's go to the monk. Well, think about the monk ability that gives you proficiency on all saving throws. Does that mean you get proficiency on your death save?
Let's find the actual rule. You can look it. I'm Googling.
What's that from?
It's Monty Python.
That would explain why we both know it so well. Death saving throws. Unlike other saving throw, this one isn't tied to any ability score. You have the hands of fate and features that include... you are in the hands of fate and aided only by spells and features that that improve your chances of succeeding on a saving throw. Holy shit.
Yeah.
Monks are fucking broken.
I kept saying that last night. All right.
Paladins are broken.
Yeah, man. It's
because they give their charisma bonus to saving throws.
You can't kill players above level like 4. It's fucking impossible. Do you have any idea how hard I try to kill you? I give all of my things. Yes, I know you do, but I want you to know that I give everybody, all of my monsters get max hit points. If they have the ability to teleport, I give them to that as a bonus to their act, to their movement. It doesn't cost them an action. And I will auto recharge if a recharge attack hasn't recharged within 2 rounds. So all the big stuff comes back. That is how I run my monsters. I homebrew it super deadly, and you guys still don't fucking drop. I've only ever killed one of you, and I've never pulled back. You guys cannot die. You've been on the raggedy brink more than once without a healer in the party, but you haven't died.
Yeah, we're slinging around a lot of potions as well.
Fifth Ed is the hero's game.
Yeah, I'm with you. There's also the instant death rule, which I've never seen a table play with.
Which is?
Massive. It's death by massive damage. Massive damage can kill you instantly. Well, when damage reduces you to 0 hit points and there is damage remaining, you die if the remaining damage equals or exceeds your hit point maximum.
Yeah, the Wednesday night game, the Charlie and Dave playing with Justin and Caitlin, they use that rule. And it's like been close a couple times to them because they're level 4.
Yeah. So,
but like, I mean, who gives a fuck when you're level 7 and above?
Well, the thing is, if you have 2 hit points and you get hit and you've got a maximum of 20.
Nothing at CR 7 is going to do your maximum amount of hit points over your maximum amount to hit you.
Unless they crit.
Yeah, but that's still only double dice and you're playing with averages. I mean, it can happen technically, but it will rarely freaking happen.
Okay.
I would say that that's meant for falling out of airships. Anyway, let's continue. Hey everyone, welcome to a special episode of It's a Mimic. I am DM Adam, and with me this time is...
DM Dan.
Apparently I got in some trouble last time for recording specials in other people's houses when they weren't home or some nonsense.
Yeah, I'm not letting you sneak into my house again.
You didn't let me the first time.
Well, now I'm actually observing.
Or the second.
Or the third.
Anyway, no, that had nothing to do with the podcast. That was just for
my entertainment. I'm still washing my hair from that.
You're welcome. Anyway, so here we are. We're looking at a new episode that's coming up. It's being released on Tuesday, as per usual. But this one that we're working on is about death and character death and dying. And I wanted to stop for a moment and talk about all the different ways that you can stave off death. When you have a character that you love, that you've been playing for months, that you are incredibly passionate about, and you know you're going into something deadly. You're going into the heart of the Necromancer's city, or you're going into the Dragon's Lair, and you have the opportunity to prep spells. What should you be looking for? This is a guide for players specifically, and we're only going to talk spells. We know that you get lay on hands for paladins. Sometimes a monk can heal themselves. Clerics are fucky healing.
You got
nonsense.
Celestial warlocks. You got divine soul sorcerers.
There's a million different traits. Yeah, the class features are through the roof with this. So we're going to focus solely on spells. We got a shit ton of them, but let me break down what we're going to talk about. We're going to talk about healing spells, because if you are at 0 hit points and you're making death saves and you get healed, bang, you're back up. We're going to talk about temporary hit points, which may stave off, drop into 0. We're going to talk about stabilizing, which is what you need to do when you are at zero hit points. But this will not necessarily bring you back up with hit points. It'll just stabilize you at zero. We're going to talk a little bit about divine intervention, protection from undeath. So if your character dies and you're waiting on a resurrection, how do you keep them from being raised as a zombie by an enemy? We're going to talk about resurrection. And we're going to talk about undeath for the necromancers that are in your party that you want to raise another party member back up again. And then there are a handful of what I like to call fucky nonsense. Fucky nonsense is all of those other ones that technically may work to restore hit points or stave off death in just a moment. But they're not necessarily the first thing you think of when it comes to dispel. So we'll save that for the end. And let's jump right into the beginning. Now we're going to go section by section, and Dan and I are going to roll initiative to see who's going to talk about what. But get comfortable. We're in here talking about heals, and it's pretty fun. I'm excited about this because we've got some neat ideas.
Yeah, for sure.
All right, let's roll initiative.
A 3.
I got a 14, so I'm going to go first. And the first thing that I'm going to bring up is Cure Wounds. We're going to start with a level 1 spell. And this is the one that everyone goes, oh, it's a magical healing episode? They must be discussing Cure fucking Wounds. So, not fucking... Never mind. This is a first level evocation. It's available for bards, clerics, druids, paladins, and rangers. It's in the player's handbook. And it's very, very simple. If you can touch a creature, it will get hit points back equal to 1d8 plus your spellcasting modifier. It doesn't work on undead or constructs, which is going to be a constant theme through this entire episode, but it also scales. At higher spell slots, you add more d8s.
Yeah.
This is a standard. Everybody in the every party I've ever seen has access to Cure Wounds.
Right. And even if it's through a wand or something like that, there's always some sort of use of Cure Wounds in a party.
Yeah, there are two ways that people like standardly heal, and it's Cure Wounds or healing potions. And this is it, right? Yeah. So 1d8 is important as well because that's the basic standard hit die for any character, yeah. Right? The majority of the characters have a d8. And that's kind of the measuring stick. So while barbarians are a little bit tougher and Cure Wounds isn't going to do as much, or it's going to do a whole lot more for sorcerers or wizards, I like Cure Wounds because it's going to do the correct amount for your clerics, your rogues, your warlocks, all your d8s, and there's lots of them.
One common mistake I do see with Cure Wounds, it's a very simple spell, and it's verbal and somatic components as well. Like it's typical spell level stuff. One, it is touch, so you do have to get close to them. And two, if you are increasing the level of it, you are only increasing it by a d8. You're not adding your spell ability modifier again either,
yeah.
which I have seen some tables do, and that's a house rule I've seen, and I'm kind of okay with it, just because the healing in this game is...
I don't know, man. You get your hit dice in a short rest. I'm okay with the healing level in this game.
True.
It's already skewed for the...
But as rules as written, you're getting an additional d8, and if you've got a 4 as your spellcasting modifier, you're still taking that 4, right? So it'll just be 2 d8 plus 4 if you bump it up to a second level spell.
Yep.
So, okay, next on the list is we're going to talk about Goodberry. You'll probably note that we're going alphabetical here.
Well, alphabetical, but also by spell level.
By spell level, yeah. So, Goodberry is a first level transmutation spell that is open to druids and rangers. You could probably get access to it with other screwy means, but typically it's a druid or ranger spell. What it does is up to 10 berries appear in your hand. You generate these 10 good berries. They are the best berries. They are the greatest berries.
No, they're not great berries. They're only good. If they were great, they would do 2 hit points, not 1.
Eating a berry increases 1 hit point worth of damage and also provides enough nourishment for the day. So you don't need to eat and you get a hit point back per berry you get, and they lose their potency after a day.
See, I really like this for the sustenance more than the 1 hit point. While the 1 hit point is good for when you drop below 0 and you're making death saves, and they just ram a berry in your mouth and smash your jaw closed,
yeah.
Bang, you're back up with 1 hit point. You're able to escape, which is fantastic. But this doesn't feel healy to me. Technically, you're gaining hit points, but this is not a game changer.
Yeah. I do have a question. We are both former Boy Scouts, so we should know this, but I'm not 100% sure. Are the berries that grow on mistletoe, are they poisonous? You're not supposed to eat those, right?
Do not eat mistletoe.
Okay. So this material component for Goodberry is a sprig of mistletoe, which leads me to believe you say the spell, you say the words, you do the action, and the berries will grow on this material component. You pick them off.
In my head, they go from red to purple.
Okay,
right. Cool. So there's a physical thing that you can see, like there's a difference to it. I like that there are 10 to them as well.
Yep.
And this feels also really useful for when a whole whack of NPCs drop at once. You've got a bunch of NPCs that you're escorting along a trail, and there's an area of effect that hits them all. They're all making death saves. You've got to pick and choose what to do, and you just cast Goodberry, hand it out to the other players, and you can bring up to 10 of them back,
yeah.
Right?
It's one of the big strengths of Goodberry is you could just hand these out to your players and your party members and your NPCs to eat whenever they need it, but they get this little one hit point buffer
carry with them. I also like that it has like an expiry date. After 24 hours, it's gone, so you can't stockpile 900 of these, right? So, I don't know. I really like it. Next up is Healing Word. This is another first level evocation for bards, clerics, and druids. It's in the player's handbook. And the thing that I like about this, first and foremost, 60 foot range on a heal. That's madness. And additionally, it's a freaking bonus action to cast it. This is fantastic, and it's only verbal. I mean, it's right in the name, Healing Word, but you don't need spell components for this. If you can speak, you can cast this.
I just see you like running by your party member who's sitting there like bleeding on the ground going, "Clot, bugger!" And then keep going. Like the spell word is clot.
Yeah. Don't fucking die! Right? But you get 1d4 plus your spellcasting modifier. Now, I know that a lot of people are like, well, that's... I would rather have the 1d8 with Cure Wounds, but Cure Wounds to me, because it takes an action and it's the 1d8, it feels more like a replacement for a hit die when you're taking a short rest, whereas Healing Word is very much about being in combat, right? You are using this on the fly. Maybe you were literally flying when you cast it.
Yeah, maybe.
At higher levels, again, this is another one that that stacks. So you add another D4 for each spell slot above the first level. But I really, really, really love Healing Word for being able to bring someone back up. This isn't just about healing people. This is like the ace in the hole. When you're at higher levels, when you're level 9, when you're level 14, Cure Wounds is not keeping pace with everything else.
No.
But Healing Word may. Because of the range and because of the versatility. And remember, you can cast a spell and a first level spell and a cantrip if it's a bonus action on the same turn, right? And because this is a first level spell, if you have an action that is a cantrip,
yeah.
Then you can cast this, you get two spells, right? That's powerful.
Yeah. So. If you're playing that like warlock bard, you hit it with an Eldritch Blast and then heal your party member on a turn. And that's completely legit.
Yeah. So, anyways, I really like Healing Word. What do we got next?
Next, we're bumping into our second level spells now. And we have Healing Spirit. This is found in Xanathar's. And it's open. It's a conjuration spell and it's open to druids and rangers. To be completely honest, this is the first I've heard of the spell. I don't see this one on tables a lot.
This is one of the most powerful spells, and you're going to find out why here in a second. Oh,
it's fantastic. So, as a bonus action, with verbal and somatic components 60 feet away, for up to a minute, you create a spirit that is looks like some sort of transparent beast or fae, if you want, no matter what you want to do there. But it appears in a 5-foot square, and then any creature you see, when they move through it, you can cause it to heal them for 1d6 per caster level.
Now, this takes concentration?
It takes concentration, but it is a little, like, turnstile of healing for your party members. You set this up as your rogue is running around the battle like a chicken with his head cut off. He just runs through this real quick, and you just go, yep, and he goes. This doesn't require an additional action on your turn. If they run through it, you just...
It's part of their movement. How much do they get back?
They get 1d6, which isn't a lot. But well,
hold on. Remember, you get 30 feet of movement. So if you're standing beside this thing, you can go in and out of that square 3 times on your turn.
Mm-hmm.
And there's nothing in the rules as written that says you cannot do that, which means you just got 3d6 healing. For free, essentially. Yeah.
There's no limit to the amount of healing this thing can dish out, as long as it's within that 1 minute timer. And if you need to move it, you could spend your bonus action to move it an additional 30 feet.
Super powerful.
Right? And then, on top of that, if you spend higher spell level slots, it's 2d6 each time. This thing is ridiculous. I love this spell.
For second level?
And it's a second level, yeah.
Yeah, this is... Here's my complaint about power creep, and it didn't take us long. Xanathar's hits, and the spells go nuts.
Yeah.
Right? So, anyway, honestly, for me, I would pick this up. It's also really flavorful if I'm a cleric, and I also have spiritual guardians, or spiritual guardian, as well as, what's the spirit guardians? What's the guardian of faith is what I'm thinking of.
So one of those might be a concentration spell. And then you couldn't do both of these at the same time.
Right, but your flavor is that you are conjuring spirits.
Yeah.
And if you have Find Familiar and Find Steed and all that, you are just conjuring shit all the time to help you out from another realm. It's fun. I like the flavor on
this. Yeah, I really like it as well.
All right, next up on the list is Prayer of Healing. There's a common theme here, right? So Prayer of Healing is a second level evocation. It's for clerics only. And it's in the player's handbook. This one is not an in-combat scenario because it takes 10 minutes to cast. But it is instantaneous once you cast it. All six creatures, or up to six creatures of your choice, that you can see within 30 feet, gain hit points equal to 2d8 plus your spellcasting modifier. Again, doesn't work on undead and constructs. And again, it stacks at higher as you blow higher spell slots, right? So this is another one where, as you know, you need a short rest, but everybody's blown to their hit dice, or you don't have the hour to give. This is going to help boost that party up again to get through that final room in the dungeon.
Yeah. Oh, and it should be noted, if we haven't noted it before, a lot of these will not work on undead or constructs.
I'm going to say it out loud if it won't work, right? Yeah, like, so
exactly.
some of these, strangely enough, will work on constructs. So if you're playing in Eberron, you have a Warforged, and it says, cannot be healed by regular magical means. Apparently it fucking can, right? So you can heal the Modron NPC with this, right?
Yeah, I'd give that to you. If you listened to our episode about undeath, and we talked about like someone having like a zombie plague,
That wasn't our undeath. That was our zombies and skeletons.
Zombies and skeletons episode. I would say that this wouldn't work, and this would be a hampering factor for that character if you're going down that route of trying to figure out how to cure this person's zombieism before it takes them over.
I would say that you regain the hit points, but it doesn't cure the disease.
Oh, I wouldn't even give them the cure of the hit points. I would just, they have to come by other means to do it.
You're just a nasty bastard then.
I tend towards it.
All right, what do we got next?
Next we have Aura of Vitality. It is a paladin-only third level evocation spell found in the player's handbook. What it does...
I like the fact that it's got range.
I like the fact that it's got range. It's got a 30-foot radius aura around you. It is an aura of vitality. But it's 30 foot around you, which means you are covering a 60 foot bubble, which is amazing. But anyways, healing energy is going to surround you inside of this thing. And until the spell ends, which is concentration up to a minute, you can use your bonus action to cause one creature in the aura to regain 2d6 hit points. I'm not a huge fan of this one. Because it is still taking up your bonus action every turn.
But it's an aura. You can get with a 30-foot... Think of that. You can walk through a crowd and heal everybody.
No, one person a turn.
One person a turn?
Yeah. You can use your bonus action to cause one creature in the aura to regain 2d6. So one creature a turn gets 2d6. You have a spell that is a druid and ranger spell that is two levels lower than this that can do as many as people walk through it. But this one, you have to spend your bonus action to give them 2d6.
Well, that's the scaling the power creep problem with Xanathar spells.
Yeah.
But I don't know. I still like this as just having it up for a bonus action.
Yeah.
If your paladin, for whatever reason, is boosting somebody else, right? If the rogue is flanking the enemy and the paladin's right up there and the rogue is the one that's being targeted, you can just... Without giving up your multi-attack at level 5 or beyond.
Yeah, that's fair enough, yeah.
You're just giving this auto-heal to someone else, which it could be useful. Is it concentration?
It is concentration for a minute.
Yeah.
And it is third level, which means your paladin's not getting access to this until 9th level.
Yeah, I don't know. You're right. It does seem weak. It does seem circumstantial. I'd rather have Healing Word for this to use your bonus
action. I find a lot of the Paladin spells are interesting, but let's be completely honest. You're spending the smite. Them smites.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Next on the list is one under Xanathar's. This one I like because it's a little bit bizarre. This is Life Transference. This is a third level necromancy spell. I love that a lot of the healing is a part of necromancy. Right? And you're going to understand why here in a second. So it's necromancy. It's for clerics and wizards. And and you can find it in Xanathar's. Okay, so it takes an action to cast. It's verbal and somatic. Your range is 30 feet, but you sacrifice some of your health to mend another creature's injuries. You take 48 necrotic damage, and then the person that you choose within the range, as long as you can see them, regains an equal number of points times 2. So 48 off the top of my head is about a 20-ish, 18 to 22 in that range. You're probably going to take that, which means they're going to regain somewhere between 36 and 44 hit points.
That's good for a wizard. Like I'm thinking, what kind of wizard is going to sacrifice their hit points, right? Because you have the smallest hit dice in the game. It's hard as a wizard to do that. But,
I mean, it's the wizard that's hiding behind the barbarian who's raging, and you just need to keep that barbarian up because he is literally your meat shield.
Yeah.
And if he drops, no matter how many hit points you have, you're fucked.
Yeah.
Right.
Exactly.
So and every hit point is worth 2 for a barbarian anyway when they're raging.
So do it. Yeah.
Right. So
I really like this spell, especially as a necromancer, because usually you're battlefield control. So you're trying to figure out something else to use your actions for, and this is fantastic for that.
Yeah, I like it as well. I mean, you can get access to any spell through the bard, right? I like the idea of these back row casters who are beefing up. They're pumping the front row meat shield,
yeah,
right? The high armor class.
Right? And it's wizard, which I love because this is the first healing spell that we've seen bards who are arcane spellcasters get some access to healing. And that's cool. But this is the first time you have a wizard that can actually do some healing. I mean, it's going to take some negative on them to do it, but it's still like the first time we see a wizard doing healing.
Yep. I think it's a lot of fun.
Yeah.
All right. What do we have next?
Next, we have Mass Healing Word.
Ooh, it's the same thing, but better.
It's the same thing, but better. As a third level spell, as a bonus action within 60 feet and an only verbal component, your...
Everybody don't fucking die.
Your cleric only... Note that Healing Word is bards and various other classes... this is clerics only, gets to heal up to 6 creatures with a healing word as a bonus action.
So it's not that you're doing more health, you're just hitting everybody with it. Yeah, yeah. Okay.
So you can up to 6 creatures of your choice, and you still get the 1d4 plus your spellcasting modifier as a third level spell. And then every spell slot above, you add another d4.
I like this. I think this is on par for third level.
This is on par for third level, especially third level cleric. Yeah, I like this. This is the, we just finished an encounter and another one is flowing into this one. Let's just give a little bit of a boost to everybody and move on.
So, sorry, did you say that this stacks, you can cast at higher spell levels?
Yes, it can.
Okay, yeah. So at this point, I'm no longer prepping Healing Word. I'm just keeping this.
Maybe I would still prep Healing Word because Healing Word is one single target and it's a first level spell. Your third level spells as a cleric are going to be used for far greater things.
Your spiritual guardians, right? Your revivify.
Yeah, so. I would still prep Healing Word because it's a good oh shit button. And you can increase the levels of it as well. But keep this one as well if you're expecting a lot of like chained fights. That's what I would do with this one.
Yeah, when you're doing the dungeon crawl.
Yeah. Yeah.
All right. Next on the docket is Aura of Life, fourth level now. It's an abjuration. We're all over the spell schools on this, right? Which I kind of like because everybody gets a little bit of healing. I mean, you're not going to get a whole bunch out of transmutation. Actually, we will later, but not a whole bunch.
Yep.
But I really wish that the healing spells would have their own class, their own thing that they would have, so that the healers matter. Instead of just giving it to the every cleric gets this, or clerics and paladins or whatever, I really feel like there should be a spell school that focuses on healing, and it should be the one that is the protection spell school.
That's abjuration?
That is abjuration. So why is it evocations and necromancy as well?
I kind of get it as well, because you want to spread the wealth amongst all the classes. So if you have your Abjuration wizard, he should be able to cast some healing spells.
Right, but I don't understand why. If you're going to do that, then shouldn't you be doing that with all your fire spells as well? Right? There needs to be a consistency to it. A lot of the charm spells are spread out amongst different spell schools as well. You'd think that they would be inside...
Enchantment,
but they're not. They're kind of spread around. Anyway, not the point. Back to the point. Aura of Life. So it just takes one action. You cast it on yourself, but it's got a 30-foot radius because it's an aura.
It's an aura.
Right? Again, concentration, but this one lasts up to 10 minutes. Life-preserving energy radiates from you in an aura. So each non-hostile creature in the aura, including you, gets resistant to necrotic damage. And your hit point maximum can't be reduced. So, yeah, that's really powerful. In addition, any non-hostile living creature regains one hit point when it starts its turn in the aura with zero hit points up to 10 minutes, which means that is 10 around. That's up to 100 hit points for everybody.
But this also means that if you are within 60 feet of the paladin, if you're somewhere within this 30-foot radius of the paladin, so...
Yeah, so it's a 60-foot
radius. A 60-foot bubble. But if you're within this, death saves don't matter to you. You get that hit point.
Yeah.
I mean, you're going to be fighting a lot of undead things here. So if you're dropped to zero hit points, there's a lot of undead that say, even if you're dropped to zero hit points, you're dead and you come back next turn.
What's interesting is it says a non-hostile living creature, which means if you drop a bad guy to zero hit points and for some reason they have death saves, they're back up with one hit point too because they're no longer hostile. They're unconscious.
Okay, yeah, I guess.
This is really good for if you want to take prisoners.
Yeah, yeah.
Right, that's where I'm coming from with this. Is this is a good where we're going to get the prisoner. He's only going to have one hit point. So that town guard or the bandit or whatever that you've taken prisoner is going to be just shitting his pants, shaking his boots, right?
Well, and the paladin would know that this spell could do that. So it would be if you guys drop this one guy, the paladin knows he's going to come up. So he's using his interaction on this turn to be like, hey, rogue, hey, barbarian, tie that guy up before the next turn because he will get up.
Right, but it's any non-hostile living creature as well, which means that your manticore is coming back.
Yeah.
Right? This can be relatively dangerous depending on how the DM interprets this, so I would be very clear about it early, right? If the DM is prone to giving death saves to boss monsters or legendary monsters or whatever it is, then they may come back.
Yeah,
and you may have another dragon's breath to deal with.
I would almost say, and I know you and I like to argue about stuff like this, but I would almost say that even if you're unconscious, but you're still fighting the party for whatever reason, you're still hostile. You're just unconscious. So the way I would put it is, if this thing's going to get up and then draw a sword and chase after the party, that thing's still hostile.
No, it's hostile again. And this is where you and I would argue on this, because I don't believe that you could be hostile while you were unconscious.
I don't know. I've had some very angry sleeps before in my life.
but you're not hostile to the other person in the room.
Just fucking snore. Just fucking snore.
Can't reduce your hit point maximum.
That reducing your hit point maximum is massive if you're fighting ghosts and
undead.
And undead.
Yeah, there's all sorts of stuff. So anyway, there we go. That was Aura of Life. What do we have next?
Next we have Mass Cure Wounds.
Ooh.
This is a 5th level evocation for your bards, clerics, and druids. Bards get this, which I love. It is a one action, 60-foot range, verbal and somatic components. And what you do is all of those creatures within a 30-foot radius sphere centered on a point within 60 feet get to heal 3d8 plus your spellcasting modifier.
Look, that sounds like a lot. But this costs a 5th level spell slot.
It's a 5th level spell slot. So within 60 feet, you create a 30-foot bubble that will heal any creatures of your choice for 3d8 plus your spellcasting modifier. And this, of course, levels up as you spend more spell slots. So 6th level, it would do 4d8. 7th level would do 5d8, etc., etc. And also has no effect on undead or constructs like other healing spells. So that one's fairly simple. It's another up to 6 creatures thing.
Yeah, it seems to be up to 6 creatures on a regular basis, which means I feel like they're saying, hey, you can heal your players, but not their mounts.
Yeah, or like choose the one animal companion that's the more important one, or the one NPC, right? Because yeah, you've got a party of five.
You're going to get that familiar that scouts ahead, right?
Yeah, exactly. That's the thing you're going to drop it on, or that one NPC. Yeah.
So,
what's next?
What's next is heal. I wonder what this does.
Hey, does it heal?
Fuck, you'd think that they should put it in the goddamn fucking name. Anyway, so this is a 6-level evocation, another action to cast, range 60 feet. We're getting the range stuff now, but I mean, we're spending the 6-level spell slot. And I feel like that's really the thing that we're getting here with these higher levels is either more people or more range. The thing that I like about this one is you choose a creature that you can see within the 60 feet, and it regains exactly 70 hit points.
Massive.
Yep. You're not rolling. This is not 48 and you rolled 4 ones, right? There's no spellcasting modifier involved here. 70 hit points. That's a weird number, but I'm sure it breaks down with what level you're getting it at and whatnot. So this one is, it's only available for clerics and druids. You can find it in the player's handbook. But my favorite thing about it is that it also ends blindness, deafness, and any diseases affecting the target. Doesn't work on constructs or undead, but you essentially regrow your freaking eyeballs.
So what level is this?
6th.
6th level. So you are level 11 when you're casting this one?
That sounds right to me.
Yeah. Which at level... what level do paladins become immune to disease and monks become immune to disease? Around level 11, right?
Yeah, it's around this point, give or take probably 2 or 3.
Yeah.
This might be a 14th level for a subclass, but...
Yeah, so this is fairly on par for what you're getting at this level anyways.
Yeah, my big thing is, again, it's curing diseases, it's not curing poisons, and it's not removing curses, right? But it is curing diseases. Disease doesn't show up enough in D&D for...
It really doesn't.
That's it. Your next character's getting gout.
My current character has gotten all sorts of things already.
Yeah, but those are STDs, Dan, and you earned those.
My next character's a paladin, fuck you.
what's interesting here is that you can cast this at higher spell slots, and you don't actually do more healing or cure more effects. You just increase the range by 10 feet.
That's all it does if you... Really?
Yeah, that's it. Now, I know that this is super powerful and it casts an action and that you may just want to be able to hit that guy that's 90 feet away. So you blow a 9th level. But we got better healings, better heals coming. Oh, yeah. This one, I would never spend the extra.
You don't need to.
No. No, I mean, unless you've run out of 6-level spell slots, you have to use an 8th or a 7th, right? But I don't know.
Okay.
There's going to be better options.
Next on the list, we have a Bard, Cleric, Druid. This seems to be the mix here.
Yeah, I mean, paladins have it naturally, and monks and some sorcerers have it occasionally, right? Barbarians and fighters can heal themselves only.
Yep.
So it makes sense that these are your ranged healers as a general rule.
Cool. So we have Regenerate, which you will find in the player's handbook. This is one of the first out-of-combat heals that we've talked about. It's got a minute-long casting time.
Well, no, we've had a couple other. There's a 10-minute one before.
So it's verbal, somatic, and the material component is a prayer wheel and holy water, which are two items that do cost money. And if you use them,
what the fuck is a prayer wheel?
It like a little spinning wheel thing.
I understand that it is a wheel and wheels turn, but what the hell? How do you use a prayer wheel?
I have absolutely no idea.
That's it. We gotta look this shit up.
Okay, we'll look it up. While Adam takes a moment to look up what a prayer wheel does, I'll just keep on going. For an hour, you can touch a creature.
You're gonna keep going for an hour?
Yeah. So the duration of regenerate is 1 hour, and for that hour, you touch a creature and stimulate its natural healing ability. So basically, you are hastening a creature's natural healing. The target will regain 48 plus 15 hit points, which is a bit peculiar that it's specifically plus 15. And for the duration of the spell, the target regains 1 hit point at the start of each of its turns, which is 10 hit points a minute. So you get this one big buff, and then for an hour, this player has a slow regenerate to it. Also, and Adam, you and I need to talk about this. There's not a lot of rules out there, like hard and fast rules for severing limbs in this game. But if you so lose a limb, it is part of, you could use regenerate to bring it back.
Yeah, one of the things that I want to point people to is the rules for trolls, because you can lop limbs off of trolls, right? And they've got a pretty useful indicator of what you lose as an option. Mm-hmm. If you lose a leg, did you know that you're only reduced to half your hit or half your movement speed? That's it. That's the only negative thing.
As someone who hasn't been able to use his leg very well for the past, 3 weeks.
Oh, yeah, you should have zero. More than that. Yeah, you should have zero healing speed. Maybe you move 5 feet around.
Yeah.
But yeah, that's it. You just lose that. And you're not even considered prone. You're technically still freaking standing.
That's bizarre to me.
It is bizarre. But anyway,
so
it requires some homebrew.
The way the regenerate works for regenerate is if you don't have the limb, it takes 2 minutes to grow it back. If you do have the limb, you can place the severed part against the stump, wherever it got cut off of, and it is instantaneously knit back together. So if your fighter loses his arm and you bring it back to the campsite and you just stick his arm back on, you cast this 7th level spell, and his arm is perfectly fine instantly. Otherwise, he's Deadpooling it for 2 minutes with his itty bitty baby legs or whatever.
I like that. You know what? I feel like lizard folk should just be able to regenerate after 1d10 days.
Oh, I 100% agree. Give that to them. I also think some forms of undead should just be able to have this knit back together thing. Like, they'll just grab an arm off a battlefield if you lob off their arm, and they'll just stick it in the socket and keep going. Like, I think that's something that some undead should be able to do as well.
Yep.
But I think the big power of this is it's not concentration. It's an hour long, and you get a hit point at the start of each of your turns. So if you are about to go into a big battle, you can have your bard, your cleric, your druid cast this on your tank, or cast this on himself, who's the healer, so that every turn he's up casting healing spells. Because how badly do things go to hell and back when your healer drops early in a fight?
Right? That's so scary. You got to get the healer back up and quickly.
Right? So that's what I would use this for. I'd say it's a little bit... I'd say it's on par for about a 7th level spell. Like, it fits for that level, in my opinion. I've definitely heard complaints that regenerates maybe a little bit too underpowered for a 7th level spell slot.
But I don't know. There's a permanent condition that somebody has where they've severed a limb or they've lost their eyes.
Yeah.
The fact that you can undo this. As a DM, for me, I want to add a sense of realism to these kind of wounds. There's special scenarios that happen. And I want it to have a lasting effect. I want the players to run in fear. This undermines that.
Yeah.
So yeah, 7th level is about right for me.
And you were saying that there are some good rules out there for severing limbs. Matt Coville wrote some, did he not?
Was it Matt Coville? I think that he had some. I run my own rules as well. But I've known everyone to just kind of homebrew it. There are some rules that are available, rules as written, but they don't make a whole lot of sense. So
fair enough. I would also encourage, and this is just something for me as a player I do enjoy, and as a DM I do enjoy crit tables. And nothing fits a crit table like dismemberment, right? So throw it in there.
Yeah, but that's a 5%. All right, you know what? Yes, but. Anyway, a prayer wheel is a cylindrical wheel on a spindle made from wood, metal, stone, leather, or coarse cotton. There's a mantra that's written on the...
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Carved on the outside. But then there are scripts, there are mantras that are inside of it as well, up to thousands, or in a large prayer wheel, millions. And what you do is you essentially hold it against yourself, or you spin the wheel, you touch it in some way and spin it, and all of that karma, all of that magic, it's a Buddhist thing, spins out and imbues you with this positivity.
Cool.
So it's actually, it looks a little bit like a mace. Right, but it's not meant to be used. It would break.
It's like a mace and a party noisemaker
have
babies.
I wouldn't give it a comedic factor.
I'm just saying,
but yeah. So,
and then I would assume like the holy water, you're pouring it over top of the prayer wheel as you're going, or whatever that mix is, but you do need both of these things to cast regenerate, or pouring holy water over the wound that you need to regenerate.
Yep. All right, let's move on to the next thing. There is no 8th level heal. There is a 9th. There are two 9th level. The first one is mass heal. This is 9th level evocation. It's clerics only. From the player's handbook, this is going to hit multiple people at range. You get 60 feet, takes an action, but you get 60 feet, and a flood of healing energy flows from you into injured creatures around you. You restore up to 700 hit points.
Oh, geez.
Divided as you choose among any number of creatures that you can see within range, within 60 feet.
Jeez.
Creatures that are healed are also cured of all diseases, not just one at a time, all diseases and any effect making them blind or deaf. And again, doesn't work on undead or creatures, mm-hmm. or on our constructs, but my God, Jesus, like this is your
big O shit button. I mean, this is the same level you're getting Wish. This is the same level, like, there's so much power here, you need a heal that can match it.
It just blows my mind that you're running around casting this for multiple sessions in late game. This is not I wish that there was 10th level spells for this stuff to land. There's such a jump between 8th and 9th. And I wish that there was that half level so that you would get this at level 20. This is your big capstone spell that, boom, you are a god among men.
There is lore for 10th, 11th, and 12th
level I know spells, there is, but it's not rules as written.
There's none in the rules as written. You can't be a level 20 wizard casting a 12th level spell unless you've done the research into it, right?
Yeah.
So,
But what do we have next? One's pretty straightforward.
That one's pretty straightforward. This one's even more straightforward. It's Power Word Heal. It is another 9th level evocation spell. It is open to just bards.
Well, it's Power Word, right? Yeah. I like that the bard is just like, heal, fucker, right?
Yeah, and what it does is quite amazing. The target, which is one target that you could touch. It is a ranged touch spell with a verbal and somatic component. They regain all of their hit points. If they're charmed, if they're frightened, if they're paralyzed, if they're stunned, they're not anymore. If they're prone, they could use their reaction to stand up.
Yeah, this is just, you're better.
Yeah,
it's okay.
It's just, hey, get up. You're fine.
And how many hit points do you get?
All of them.
All of them. Yeah, okay.
I was waiting to your max.
I was waiting for you to say a number and like, no, just all. Yeah, yeah. Just the yes number of hit points.
You regain all of its hit points. This is your barbarian. And I mean, you're casting this at level 20, right?
Yeah.
So your barbarian who's got 300 something hit points by level 20, you're just like, and you're fine.
Mm-hmm.
Right? How this compares with Mass Heal?
I would say that the fact that Mass Heal can't bring you back if you're paralyzed, right?
Yeah.
This one is also, it feels like it has restoration magic involved in this as well, beyond blindness, deafness, and the intangible concept of whatever the fuck disease is in D&D.
Yeah.
Right? So.
Which, we've heard that rant.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And you'll hear it again, goddammit. All right, so. I don't have any final thoughts. I mean, that's just like, all right.
Healing spells are healing spells, man. Like, they're. I find a lot of people just focus on, I've got cure wounds, I'm good. No, there's a lot that you could do. There's a lot of different varieties here. Go for it and actually look into these other spells for your characters, depending on your level.
A lot of them are circumstantial. I mean, as if you are not inspired by cure wounds anymore, then you need to look out. There are other options out there is the point of this entire episode. So, the big thing is, remember, if you have 0 hit points, you are making death saves, any one of these affects you.
Yeah.
So, let's move on to temporary hit points. This is going to boost you up. When you're at 0, you can get bumped up, but it also...
at the duration of the spell, you lose those hit points
again. Yeah, and you're back down to 0. So, this is a Band-Aid. You're not stopping the bleeding, you're just holding the artery closed with your fingers, right?
Yeah.
So, the first one...
We're going to roll for this one, right?
Yep. We're going to roll.
We're now talking about temporary hit points. Let's roll for it. I rolled a 7.
I got a 9. I'm going first again.
All right. So, hey.
The first one is Heroism. That is first level enchantment. It's for bards and paladins. You can find it in the PHB. Paladins, I find, are a lot of temporary hit points, whereas clerics are restoring hit points.
Yep.
Here's what it is. A willing creature, so they have to want it, and you have to be able to touch it. Yeah, that's right. I went there. It's imbued with bravery. So it can't be frightened. They're immune until the spell ends, which is concentration up to a minute. And they gain temporary hit points equal to your spellcasting ability modifier at the start of each of its turns.
Yep. Love it.
Up to a minute. So let's say that you have a plus four because you're a paladin.
So your spellcast modifier as a paladin is charisma.
Yep. So let's say that you have a plus four. You just have built it early to be a plus four. That means that they're getting four temporary hit points up to 40 temporary hit points if you keep your concentration for the minute.
Right? Well, really?
Yeah.
Because temporary hit points don't stack.
This one specifically says gains temporary hit points equal to your spellcasting ability modifier at the start of each of its turns. I would say the temporary hit points from different sources do not stack. This one is about consistent regaining the way that regeneration works.
I don't know. I might fight you on that one. Because
it's a first level spell and that seems pretty powerful.
It seems very powerful to have 40 hit point bank, and the book is fairly clear on where of how temporary hit points work, right? And you take the highest number source whenever you're calculating your temporary hit points. So things like, we'll talk about them later, aid and heroism, your aid is going to outlast your heroism, right? Just because you just get the four. So if you hit the four and you didn't get hit that turn and you still have the four, you're not getting another four. You're just at the four.
Okay.
That's the way I would run this.
All right.
Right? And that feels on par for a first level spell as well.
I'd be really clear with your DM about this before you pick it up going, oh my God, this is fantastic.
Yeah, you need to, this is definitely part of your session zero. You talk to your, or not even session zero, just pull your DM aside and be like, hey, exactly how does this work? Based on the rules of temporary hit points, they do not stack. So you got to take, if you've got the four, you got the four. If you took 2 points of damage because you got stung by something,
you go back up to four.
You go back up to that four.
All right. So here's the other cool thing about it is at higher levels, you can blow more, like higher spell slots for this, right? So what you can do is you can add more creatures to get this.
I like that.
Yeah. So you're not increasing the number. It's always four, but there we go.
Cool. Next on the list is a second level abjuration spell that is available to clerics and paladins.
This one's a pretty straightforward. A lot of people. This is one of the more famous temporary hit points.
This one is aid, and I love it. Aw. Second level abjuration, like I said, it's got an action as a casting time. Range 30 foot. It's verbal, somatic, and you got to have a tiny little piece of white cloth. My thing is like it's like a Band-Aid. You have a piece of gauze with you.
I would say a bandage, not a Band-Aid.
Bandage, yeah. You got some gauze with you. And then its duration is 8 hours.
Huh.
Not concentration, 8 hours.
Jeebus.
I know some warlocks get access to this, and it's fantastic as one of their spells that they blow their spell slot on, then they hit their short rest, and they still have the effect. I love it. So what this spell does is it boosts your party's hit point maximum by 5 for the duration.
The party's hit point maximum, so the whole party gets 5.
And their current hit points by 5.
So, hold on. Each member in the party gets
up
a plus 5?
Up
to 3 members. Yeah. No, hold. My question is, that 5, are you splitting it amongst 3 members, or do they each get 5?
Each target's hit point maximum and current hit points increase by 5.
Okay.
So this isn't temporary hit points. This is increasing your maximum and current hit point level.
For a short period of time.
8 hours.
Okay, that's still a short period of time.
Yeah.
You are not. This is not a permanent increase, therefore it is a temporary hit point.
Yeah, fair enough. That's fair enough. At 8, with higher levels, if you use a higher level spell, you get to increase that total by 5 for every spell slot above 2nd. So if you're hitting them with a 3rd level aid, you're hitting them with 10 as an increase to their maximum hit points, and that, of course, fills up when you hit it, right?
Yep.
Which means heroism and aid would stack.
Yep.
Is the way I'd rule it, because it is a temporary hit point, but it is not temporary hit points the rule, right? Mm-hmm. The hit points leave eventually, but it increases your maximum, which means for a heroism spell, you get your 4 on top of that. You could be rocking around with, you know, plus 9 hit points to your character, and every turn they get an additional 4.
Yeah.
If they lose some. So it's for 8 hours, your party has plus 5 hit points to their max.
Cool.
I love it.
All right, so the next one, I'm going to drop a knowledge bomb on you, Dan. I don't think you know this one. This is from Xanathar's. It's Guardian of Nature. This is a 4th level transmutation, only available to druids and rangers, and it's weird.
And a lot of Xanathar spells are weird.
Yeah, but it's weird in a good way. First of all, only bonus action and only verbal.
What?
Yep.
Okay.
As a fourth level transmutation.
Bonus action fourth level spell.
Yep.
Yikes.
It takes concentration and it can last up to a minute. But here's the thing. A nature spirit answers your call and transforms you into a powerful guardian. You you keep this transformation until the spell ends. You choose one of the following forms: Primal Beast or Great Tree. Primal Beast, fur covers your body and your facial features become feral. And so I'm just going to blow through this because this is not the healing stuff.
Yeah.
Your walking speed increases by 10. You get 120 dark vision. Your any strength-based thing attack is with advantage. Your melee weapon attacks deal an extra 1d6 force damage on a hit. But Great Tree is your skin appears barky, leaves sprout from your hair, and you gain the following four things. You get 10 temporary hit points.
Okay.
You make constitution saving throws with advantage. Okay. Every con save. You make dex and wisdom-based attack rolls with advantage. That's powerful for rangers and druids, right?
Yeah.
And while you are on the ground within 15 feet of you is difficult terrain for your enemies. Specifically for your enemies, not for your friends.
What level is this?
This is a fourth level transmutation.
Yikes.
Bonus action. Concentration up to a minute. Here's the thing about it with the temporary hit points, though. If you are hurting and you drop to zero, all of this shit goes away. Mm-hmm. You cannot cast this or have it cast upon you to get those temporary hit points to bring you back up.
Yeah, this is target self, right?
You absolutely 100% have to be conscious. Yes, you are targeting yourself. No one else can cast this upon you.
Yeah.
So here is my, just as a brief aside, here's one of my favorite homebrew rules that I would love to inject into my game. If you are at zero hit points, you can choose to remain conscious and get your full turn. And get your movement and action only. You don't get bonus action or reaction with this because you're at zero hit points. And you get, but you automatically lose a death save. So this is that last heroic push of, I'm still up and I'm still fighting and here we go. Right? And so you're still in combat. So you automatically lose one. And chances are you're in battle, so they're going to hit you and you're going to lose another one. Right? I really like that idea of the heroic push through.
Yeah, I mean, there are so many ways to stand back up after you've been knocked down in this game, whether through class features or through race features for someone like half-orc, right? There's so many ways to do it. I don't see the squirrely little druid or ranger doing this, like having that like heroic rah-hah, right? I don't know.
The other thing that
it's an interesting rule. Like I'd be interested to see how it actually plays out.
I would say maybe because this is a homebrew rule that I saw in an actual play, right? That they were playing with, and the way that I saw it run, maybe the ruling is a little different. The guy sacrificed himself for three rounds and died. Maybe you can choose to sacrifice your character, but still act for the last three rounds, get 18 more seconds of life, but you are going to die. You give up your life to save the burning tavern, right?
Yeah, it's got a bit of a dramatic heroic moment to it.
You give the player the option to go out with a bang.
I'm down. I'm be interested to see how it is. I would give them an action and half movement.
Yeah,
because you're blur, right? But at the same time, we've also discussed about having like the bloodied condition in our games as well, and how that mechanically would work. We'd have to iron out as well. So I think if I'm bringing in bloodied, I'd bring in this.
Yeah.
Right.
Anyway, so for Guardian of Nature, this is not going to keep you from, or this is going to stabilize you while you're already down. It's got to bring you back up. Okay. Right. So, or you have to have this beforehand is my point.
Fair enough. Another prep, and this is the next spell on our list, is a spell that every single high level party should start their delve into a dungeon with. This is how you begin every single little next leg of your adventure, is with a hero's feast. It is a 6th level conjuration spell that takes 10 minutes to cast. Its range is 30 feet, but really
this is cleric and druid only.
This is cleric and druid only. Yes, cleric and druid only for this. But the big thing that this costs, and a lot of people go over this, is a gem encrusted bowl worth 1,000 gold that the spell consumes. says within the spell there that it actually consumes that bowl.
When it starts to get specific like that, I don't give a shit about your sprig of berries. I'm just going to assume you have that nonsense. But when you want to start using Hero's Feast, you need to go to town and get one of these bowls.
Exactly.
Right? And right? So this is...
And if you're in Podunk Nowhere, where are they going to have a 1,000 gold bowl?
Yeah, so...
Right?
Anyway.
So, like, this has got to be a get. But it's 6th level, so, I mean, you've got teleportation magic at this point. Go get a bowl. And what it does is it brings forth a great feast. I love the phrasing of that. And it takes... Basically, you create this meal that takes an hour to consume.
It's a bucket of KFC.
But, like, good KFC. The kind that you're not going to be sitting on the other kind of bucket for a couple hours.
I'm sorry, there's a good KFC?
If you've got... It, I don't know. It's better than Popeyes.
You are fucking wrong.
I know I am.
All right, hold on. We're going to pause this while I beat the shit out of Dan. And we're back.
I love Popeyes. Popeyes is the shit.
Sponsor us.
So, back to Hero's Feast. What it lets you do is any creature that partakes in the feast is cured of all diseases and poison.
Of course.
Of course. They become immune to poison and frightened.
For how long?
The next 24 hours.
Yeah, all right. You know, honestly, everything at this level is going to have some sort of frighten effect to it anyway. Like, a lot of your dragons and shit are going to have frightful presence.
Yep.
So I'm okay with this.
You get advantage on all wisdom saving throws for the next 24 hours. Anyone who partakes this feat.
Good God. Okay.
Yep.
So it just turns you into a freaking druid or a monk.
And you increase the hit point maximum of whoever eats this feast by 2d10 for 24 hours.
I'm okay with that because there's going to be that poor bastard that rolls 2 ones.
Now, I have a question for you, Adam. A rules question.
Yep.
Do aid and Hero's Feast stack?
No.
Why not?
Temporary hit points don't stack.
Temporary hit points don't stack, but these aren't temporary hit points. These are increasing your hit point maximum.
Look, this was in the wording of another one as well. Just because they're not using the word temporary hit points does not mean that these are not temporary hit points, right?
So, well, temporary hit points go above your maximum. That's what they say. These are actually increasing your maximum.
Okay, you're splitting hairs. You get all fucking sorts of pedantic when I start talking about whether or not poison is toxin or venom. And you're like, well, no, they're all separate. Then these are separate.
We're both getting equally pedantic on that one, let's be honest, right? But like, it's...
No, just you dick.
But no, it's just both of us.
Yeah, fuck you. I will
fight you again.
Here we go!
That went a little bit better for me that time.
I don't like you anymore.
Anyways, so... I don't know, man. I would rule that they stack. Because it's not... actually temporary hit points. If it said it was temporary hit points, they would say temporary hit points. It's temporary by the nature of the spell, but it's basically just increasing your maximum hit points, which means you are running as business as usual with just a higher hit point total, right? So I would say aid and Hero's Feast stack.
All right, and I would say that when a snake bites you, it's toxin based on the nature of the creature, not poison, but there you go.
But there's no toxin rules in the game.
Right, so what they do is they just have to... They call it poison damage, and then they call out poison conditions and poison resistance and poison immunity, not poison. So when they say poison, it's got to be a different thing. What's the same way that this is a different thing from temporary hit points.
Fair enough.
You're either all or nothing on this. You can't pick and choose the shit that you like. All right, let's jump into stabilizing then.
All right.
All right, because this is the one where, I mean, everyone's already looking at Spare the Dying, right? But when you're down, when you're making those death saves, what spells are going to help you get back up or at least not bleed out in the middle of a battlefield?
Do we want to go over what we just learned about death saves?
Yeah, sure, absolutely.
So I was wrong.
God, I mean, that turns me on, Dan. Yeah, I love hearing
I was so wrong, Adam. Speaking of things that are so wrong.
So wrong.
This conversation. Anyways, I had always thought the D20 roll on a death save was its own thing. There's no modifiers that could affect it. There's nothing that could
Well, it's written right into it that it's not tied to a stat, right?
It's not
so
tied
you're
to
not
a stat.
Getting a modifier yeah. right off the bat. So your advantage on con saves, which it used to be in the past,
yeah.
right? When you had a bonus to a con save, that would be a bonus to a death save.
But death saves are still saving throws. So anything in this game, and this is in the rules, anything in this game that affects a saving throw, a generic saving throw.
No, not anything. It specifically says only spells and features. Therefore, not items.
Fair enough, yeah. But, so, things like Bless, which will give you D4, you could add that D4 to your D20 roll on a death save.
Yeah. Yeah, and we'll awesome. Go through. That's what we're doing right yeah. now is for the stabilization. What is going to help you with a death save?
Yeah. Yeah, it's great.
So, let's roll for it.
I got a 17.
I got a 16.
Suck a bitch. All right, so we're going
to tell me to suck a bitch?
No, I said you should suck it, bitch. I was titling you as a bitch.
That's just cruel and uncalled for, Dan.
Well, no, it takes one to know one. Anyways,
it takes an unkind word to...
No, it takes an unkind bitch to
so see you're, bitch. So you're saying that you're a bitch, too? Is that what you're...
Well, yeah, fairly. Yeah, I'm okay with it.
Yeah, because you're a little bitch. All right.
Spare the dying. There necromancy crant.
That's what you get, bitch.
It's a necromancy fuck. Why are we friends?
Are we? Like, shit.
I think we're just polite adversaries. Or we're just two cowards who hate each other. I don't know. Anyways, so Spare the Dying is a necromancy cantrip that is available to clerics.
Period.
Period. Just clerics.
You can find it in the PHB, though, right?
Yeah, and there are, like we mentioned earlier, there are some ways to get it with other classes, but clerics are the only ones that get it.
But get it standard anyway.
And get it standard. It is a one action casting time with a range of touch, verbal somatic components. And what you do is you touch a living creature that has zero hit points and you stabilize it. No more death saves for you. You're good.
You don't get one hit point. You are not conscious. You're not back up on your feet. You are just no longer dying.
Yeah. And has no effect on undead and constructs. So,
I mean, that makes sense.
That makes sense.
Spare the dying, not spare the already dead or lifeless.
Yeah.
Right. So now I'm into it. This is the only cantrip we're talking about today.
Really, the only one?
That's the only one. There's no spell. There's no cantrip that gives healing. And there's... What?
Because of what we learned about saves, I would argue that guidance is something we should mention as well.
Interesting.
And resistance, to be honest.
Okay, so what's the thing about Spare the Dying that is so freaking overpowered? It has a bad reputation amongst DMs.
Yeah, it's a pause button for a character's death.
Right, but do you have to be right up to them?
Yeah, you got to touch them.
Right, so
the dying.
So the reason that guidance it is not applying to die to guidance is that guidance is on ability checks.
Okay, cool. What about resistance?
But you're resistant to like a certain kind of
No. The cantrip resistance specifically. What it does is you touch a willing creature and they could add a D4 and add the number rolled to one saving throw of its choice.
Okay.
This would apply to death saving throws.
I would argue that you, just as you are not hostile when you are unconscious, you are not willing when you are unconscious. You do not give permission for this. Look, this comes down to the fact that you're not allowed to give CPR to someone, or you can be sued if you give CPR to someone that is unconscious and they don't want it.
Here's another way. I see what you're saying, and I could also argue for that same point that the target then decides when to give the D4, and if you're unconscious, you're not deciding a damn thing.
Yeah.
So I can understand that.
So I don't include resistance in this. This is, Spare the Dying is meant to stabilize you, and that's it.
Yeah. Now, if you run the rules that we talked about before where you're conscious but still making death-saving throws.
This is a different factor. Yeah. So, okay. I don't really have anything else to say about Spare the Dying.
Neither do I. And the only reason why I brought up the other stuff is because I'm looking forward to the next one, which is...
Bless. Yes. It is a first-level enchantment that is only available to clerics and paladins. It's available in the player's handbook. And it's got a 30-foot range, concentration up to a minute, and it costs an action, but you can hit three creatures at once with this. If the majority of your party goes down all at once, you can bless three people, and they get to add a D4 to any roll to any save, right? Any attack roll, which doesn't apply here, or saving throw. This is a saving throw. It does count, which means you are giving people not advantage, you're giving them an advantage to get back up.
Yeah, right? And the reason why, and this is different from resistance because it is a external gift given to somebody on all of their rolls, not a ability that then they spend.
Yeah, so the other thing too is that you can cast this at higher levels where you add more creatures, right?
Yeah.
So there's nothing here about you can't do it to undead or constructs because this is bless. I'm assuming that it's divine intervention, right? That's what we're talking about here. And because there's gods involved, this just works, right? They just get it. There's no choosing it. There's no, oh, well, he's technically a zombie, so he's not going to get it. No, the god says, yes, get the fuck back up.
Right? Exactly, yeah.
So what do we have next, Dan?
Next, we have Warding Bond. Warding Bond is a second level abjuration spell that is for, shocker, clerics. Just clerics.
Most of this is clerics.
Yeah, it's got a range of touch. It's an action to cast.
Every time that you say it's got a range of touch, it makes me twitch because it's just a terrible like grammatic phrase. So like, I understand that you have to touch someone is the point, but fuck.
It has it has verbal, somatic, and a material component of a pair of platinum rings. Worth at least 50 gold each.
This is just flavor shit to me.
It's just flavor shit.
I don't give a crap, man. This is second level abjuration. But
the thing is, you connect yourself to another person. So it's like you're wearing one ring, they're wearing the other ring, and that is the source of the magic. That is where the connection
point right,
of
magic rests. Me as a DM is not going to sit there and be like, oh yeah, where are your rings? You didn't go to a store to get your rings. Man, if you chose the spell, you got it. Right?
This I don't know. It's 50 gold is a bit. It's if it's 10 gold, I'm with you 100%. 50 gold, even as a second level spell, is a significant enough purchase for most parties. Now, you also kind of have that Call of Cthulhu style of running wealth where if your characters are a certain level, you just kind of assume they can afford a certain level of things, right?
Yeah.
A lot of DMs don't do that, and they actually make their party members calculate how much gold they're spending on every little minutia thing.
Yeah.
And I get it. That's just a different style of play. 50 gold to me is something I would still be like, guys, just remember you need that 50 gold ring.
Look, I'm for tier one, I'm counting gold pieces. For tier two, I'm counting the tens column of gold pieces. And for tier three and four, I don't give a shit anymore. Can you afford this? Does it make sense?
Yeah. It also brings in an interesting thing with dismemberment, where if you cut off the ring, does the ward stop? Like if you cut off the limb that has the ring?
Hokey dokey magic bullshit. It still works.
I don't know. I'd say that it the connecting point is the rings based on the flavor. If they chop off your arm.
What's it connecting to? It's connecting to you, and you cast the magic upon the ring. The ring is still there, right? But yeah, hold on. Is this concentration?
It is not. It is 1 hour duration.
Oh, shit. So, no, because it's not concentration. If it was concentration, I'd be like, no, man, you lost an arm. This doesn't work. But you have cast this upon the rings. It freaking works.
Well, I would say it's based off rings. So the person would have to like lean down, pull the ring off their disembodied hand and put it on their other one to get the benefits.
How do they pull it off and put it on the other hand?
With their mouth.
You just, you know, Dan, you make me uncomfortable.
So anyways,
turn my Odie into an innie every time.
What this spell does is it wards a willing creature you touch. And creates a mystical connection between the two of you.
See, it's mystical. Between the two of you.
Through the rings. Anyways, while the target is within 60 feet of you, it gains plus one AC and it gains plus one bonus to AC and its saving throws. So this would apply to your death saves. And it has resistance to all damage, period.
Yep.
Also, each time it takes damage, you take the same amount of damage.
I know. That's the asterisk on the end of this because it's so powerful. But now, wait a minute. This is why I like the idea of the ring on there so that they get hit and the arm just like jumps like a fish out of water. Right? They're still connected. I like that. I think it's more fun. Like, they get hit with necrosis and the severed arm withers on the ground. I don't know. I just like that. The arm catches on fire. Right? They get hit by a fireball. Like the fingernails turn black and start to smoke.
Yeah.
I like it for flavor.
It's all the stories you hear about twins like being a far way away and one of them like gets hit in the stomach. The other one gets stomach pain.
Yeah.
Like that kind of thing. However, if you if the spell ends, if any one of the parties drops below zero hit points or you guys become separated by more than 60 feet.
Okay, then it just, its spell ends, and if you get back in 60 feet, it doesn't reconnect. You have to cast it again.
Exactly.
Okay.
You can also dismiss it as an action if you really wanted to, sure. But it's an action to dismiss it. Most spells, if they've got a concentration, you just stop concentrating on it. And you're
done. You said this isn't concentration, right?
Exactly. So it requires an action to stop.
This is like, that goddamn rogue decided to go forward into the hallway full of fire. All right, I need to take my action to not get beaten by this horrible... this horrible damage. Okay, cool. I like that. Next on the list is Death Ward. We have a fourth level abjuration. This one is, surprise, surprise, clerics and paladins.
What?
Yep. It's again in the player's handbook. This one is, you touch a creature and grant it a measure of protection from death. So the first time that the target drops below zero hit points, as a result of taking damage. So not like there are some things that are cumulative. Or it automatically drops you like power word kill.
Mm-hmm.
That's not damage. You just drop to zero. This doesn't count.
Okay.
Right? The target instead drops to one hit point and the spell ends. But when you cast this, it takes an action. You got to touch a person. And it runs for 8 hours. No concentration. It's just, you know what? I'm going to give this. This is another way my meat shield to stay standing.
Yeah. This is a gimme. This is giving your meat shield a gimme.
Or keeping your healer up.
Yep.
Right? So, if the spell is still in effect when the target is subjective to an effect that would kill it instantaneously without dealing damage, that effect is instead negated.
Wow. Okay.
And Death Ward ends.
Yeah.
Right? That's powerful. This is something that is going to keep you from dying.
And it's also something that's going, it's very powerfully fighting a lot of ghosts and undead, like we mentioned before, that have these, if you drop below zero, you're dead abilities.
Yep.
Yeah, I love that.
So, I like the idea of stat damage as well, and I often inject that as a homebrew rule into this game. I would allow Death Ward to work on any statistic. So if your strength drops to one, you're technically dead. I would have this bump you up to two, yeah. And the Death Ward leaves. So that's why I would run that. What do we have next on the list?
The next spell we have is a wizard-only spell in the Transmutation School. Here's your Transmutation spell, my friend.
Yep.
Requires an action. Range touch.
Stop saying, goddamn. Fuck off. Yep.
It's verbal and somatic with a material component of... gems worth, a powder consisting of gem dust worth at least 5,000 gold points, which the spell consumes. So this is a big cost to it. Well, this spell is sequester.
It's a 7th level spell.
Seventh level.
This should have a big cost to it.
It should, yeah. So what the spell does is it is your suspended animation spell, as we've... you and I have discussed off mic briefly. What it is when you cast the spell and touch the target, that target becomes invisible, and then time doesn't move for them anymore.
Which means when they are doing death saves, you can cast this on them so that everyone will have disadvantage to hit them if they even know where they are. But this doesn't have a duration. This goes for fucking ever.
Forever. Until the duration is until dispelled. So not only does it work on creatures and objects... whatever you cast the spell on is blackout for any sort of divination magic or location finding magic. You cannot detect where this thing is, and it's also invisible.
You can smell it though. If you got like
keen smell. If you're in the same room,
yeah.
you could smell it. You could probably find it if it's invisible, but
you'll trip over it.
Right? So this is time stops for this thing until you want it to be, and no one's going to like use scry to find out where it is.
So here's what I'm thinking. When you when your cleric goes down and no one has any heals, right? And you need to come up with a way to heal them, but you're in the heat of battle. You spend your action as a freaking wizard to say, all right, I'm taking you off the battlefield. Bang. Yeah, I know that you've already got one success, one failure on your death saves, but I'm taking you out. That goes on pause.
Yeah.
When the battle is over, we will come back to you and pour a healing potion down your throat, or I'll recharge a wand, or whatever it is, and we can get you back up. We got to go through your backpack to find the holy relic that can bring you back.
Yeah.
But we can't do it right now. So bang, you're going into suspended animation, and you're done. Unless somebody hits you, is that right?
Yeah, if you take any damage, the spell will end. Or if the target takes any damage, the spell will end. And you can also set your own arbitrary limits to when it ends, right? The examples in the book are when the Trask awakens or after 1,000 years. Those are the examples. It could be, you know, in an hour when we're out of here. So we don't have to carry your ass back to the Neverwinter.
Yeah, right? Or when like, when the this word is spoken and stuff like that.
Yeah.
This feels to me, this is the Sleeping Beauty spell.
Yes, very much so. I would agree. The one thing I love about this on top of all of that is this is a great campaign plot hook level spell.
Yeah.
As well, like...
when you want to retire a character as well, but you don't want them to die and you want to just take them off the playing field.
Yeah.
Here, this sequester is great for that.
Yeah. And if a character or an NPC of great importance is dying of a spell plague or something, sequester.
Yeah.
Right? And that person is now paused until you can find a cure. Right?
What's really cool, so you're talking campaign hooks now, and I'm thinking about the wizard that was in town, and this is a 7th level spell, so he'll have a couple of slots of this at high levels, right? And he casts this on one citizen at a time inside, and you go into the town, and there's nobody there. Everyone has been placed in their bed, and they are sleeping, and they're just in suspended animation, as he is waiting to gain the power to do a thing.
True.
Right?
It'd be hilarious if he misplaces one because they're invisible for this entire duration.
Oh,
as
yeah,
well.
Yeah, it's fun.
Right? And no divination magic can find them. So, like, he does this to somebody, and then there's, you know, the beast outside is calling his name, and he's got to run out, gets distracted, forgets about them. And now your party, 200 years down the line, is walking through this abandoned village and trips over this invisible dude on the ground, who then wakes up.
Well, they got to take damage. So, here's the other thing that I want to say. If you've got death saves, all right, so Dan, you go down in the middle of a round, right?
Yeah.
And then on the next round, you fail a death save. And the next one, you succeed. And the next one, you fail. And then I cast sequester on you to hold you still. And then someone causes damage to you. Damage is an automatic failure. You are dead. It's not just undoing the spell. That is still damage against you, and you are dead.
Well, a damage includes as a failed death save, right?
That's what I'm saying. Yeah, if so that is the third one.
Yeah, right? Exactly. The thing is, this also doesn't have to, like, yes, it's a great oh shit button for someone who's unconscious and on the ground. You could do this to a fully healthy creature and just take them out.
Oh, yeah,
I mean,
absolutely.
They have to be willing.
But in the framework of this episode,
yeah.
This is really, like, I'm focusing on death saves only,
yeah,
right?
This spell is, it's plot hook heavy. Like, I would... As a player, I probably would never take it. It would be in my spell book, and I would use it as a, like, oh shit button if I ever needed to, but it's never one I'm preparing.
Yeah.
Right? So, anyways, that's me.
So, the last one is Holy Aura. This is a 8th level abjuration, and again, clerics only. This one is pretty straightforward. You cast it upon yourself. It has a tiny reliquary worth at least 1,000 gold points containing a sacred relic.
This does not consume the sacred relic. The spell does not consume this.
No, it doesn't. But, like, that's really specific. You got to go to a temple to get this, right? So the idea here is that there's a soft radiance that radiates from you in a 30-foot radius. Like I said, radiance and radius 3 times there.
Yep.
When you cast the spell, it sheds dim light and so on and so forth. Everybody within 5 feet of you gets advantage on all saving throws, and other creatures have disadvantage on attack rolls against them. This is just another one that is kind of helpful. I don't know why it's an 8th level, except for, in addition, when a fiend or undead hits an affected creature with a melee attack, the aura flashes with a brilliant light, and the attacker must succeed with a con saving throw or be blinded. That feels really weak for an 8th level. I'm not sure I would ever pick this up.
It really does. I think it's because it's an aura.
I still wouldn't pick this up. It's concentration up to a minute. I'm doing that kind of the shit at the 5th level spell, right?
Like, yeah, fair enough.
I don't know. I don't think I would take this one. It's okay, but it's just advantage on saves.
But all saves.
But all saves, yeah. But, I mean, there are a few that are advantage on saves, right?
Yeah, that's fair enough.
So, anyway, next up we have what I like to call the intervention, where there's somebody else that shows up that is going to fuck around. Let's roll initiative on this one, Dan.
Okay. 4, 13.
Ooh, a 13.
Go ahead.
All right, so.
Glad you went first, because I'm looking at this list going, what the hell?
Here,
why is this spell on this list?
All right, because, and I will show you. Here is where we start to get a little bit fucky, all right? Conjure Fae. 6-level conjuration. Druids and wizards can do this. This is the first time we've seen that crossover, which is kind of fun.
Yeah.
Right? It's in the player's handbook, although you're going to need the monster manual for this too. So the way the Conjure Fae works is it takes a minute to cast, so this is not something you're doing
in combat.
In combat. There's a 90-foot range, and it takes concentration, or it allows you to, with concentration, keep this running for up to an hour. Okay, you summon a fae creature of a challenge rating 6 or lower, or a fae spirit that takes on the form of a beast at 6 or lower. So, here's the thing. The fae shows up, it's friendly to you, it can roll initiative, and it has its own turns, it obeys any verbal commands that you issue to it, but it doesn't take an action by you. It does... You can't make it violate its alignment, which, I mean, is fair, right? If you don't issue any commands to it, it defends itself from hostile creatures, but otherwise it doesn't do anything, right? And if your concentration is broken, it doesn't disappear. Instead, you lose control of it, and it becomes hostile towards you. So, here's the thing about it. You can summon a dryad because it is challenge rating 1. And dryads naturally cast, or good berry, up to 3 times a day. So if you are desperate for heals, this is a good way out. Isn't that fucky?
That's, yeah, you're spending a 6th level spell to bring in many dryads?
To bring in, I believe it is a dryad.
It's one creature up to 6th CR?
Up to a CR 6, yeah. So if you want a dryad, because dryads have other crazy stuff as well, but if you are looking for, because it's got tree stride, so it can move around the forest and look into shit. It's a great scout, yeah. Things like that. So if you're looking at your fae, you have Conjure Fae, and you're like, you know what, we also need a little bit of healing. Goodberry exists through the dryad. This is technically a spell that you can cast that can provide some healing. That's fucky. I love it, but it's fucky.
Cool.
All right. What do we have next, Dan?
Next we have Soul Cage, which is a spell that is given to us from Xanathar's. It is available to warlocks and wizards.
This is another 6th level, right?
It's another 6th, it's another 6th level necromancy spell. Its casting time is 1 reaction, which you take when a humanoid within 60 feet of you dies.
Good lord.
Yeah. So it's got a range of 60 feet, clearly. And you need to carry around with you a tiny silver cage worth 100 gold. No, that's fair enough. Doesn't consume it. The duration of the spell is 8 hours, and Soul Cage does a lot. So we're just
gonna... Let's just focus on the healing aspect of it.
So what you can do is you use your reaction to trap a soul that you see within your little soul cage. It remains in this cage until the spell ends or until you destroy the cage. And while you have the soul inside the cage, you can exploit it in a number of ways. You can use a trapped soul up to 6 times inside that cage. And once you exploit a soul for the last time, it's released and the spell is over. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
While the soul is trapped, also, it cannot be revived or raised from the dead. Because you have the soul trapped.
Right. So this requires you to have consciousness, right? In order to do it, this is one of the things about it.
Passive. Yeah, this isn't a passive thing. This is, you have to have this thing to you, and it's a reaction to cast the spell to begin with. So what you can do in order to heal yourself with the soul cage is you can use your bonus action to drain vigor from the soul, is the way they put it. Basically, you drain 2d8 hit points out of it.
Yikes.
Yep. Now, what's really funny is you can soul cage a goblin, which has 1d6 hit points, and you are sucking 2d8 for 6 rounds, because you have this times.
It's dead.
Out of it, right? Like, you're good. And you can use a bonus action to use, and you can do this again with death saves. I think, no, it's on a bonus action. Your next attack roll, ability check, or saving throw, you can roll with advantage. Which is cool. Which if you die before, if you do this before you die, you do this on the round before you die, would you get that advantage on your next saving throw?
Yes.
Okay, cool.
So this is all about timing, right?
Yeah, it's all about timing.
So yeah. A lot of this stuff is weird timing. The conjured Fae was also about timing. You needed the time to cast that spell before battle. This is not something that's going to like pull your ass out of the fire.
Exactly.
Right?
So you can use this before you drop to make sure you have advantage on that death save.
Yeah.
Which is another thing you could do.
Much like Conjure Fae is our next one, Conjures Celestial. It's a 7th level conjuration, obviously. It's for clerics, no one's surprised. And it's in the player's handbook. This one is another one that requires you to summon another being. It's the same basic idea, but it takes a higher spell slot to do it. It takes a minute to cast. You cast it within 90 feet of you.
Yeah.
And you need concentration to last for up to an hour. But it's the same thing. It has its own initiative and everything else. But here's... Here's the only way you get healing with it. I know you're thinking Celestials, they all have healing shit. They do. They're all above level 4, and that's the highest you can cast this. You can get a CR4 creature or lower. So the only thing you can get is a Coatl.
The flying Celestial snake thing, yeah.
Yeah, which is lawful good, and you can't make it do things that it won't want to do. It's the same thing, but it gets 3 times a day Bless, which we talked about before, and Cure Wounds, and Lesser Restoration, and Sanctuary, and Shield. And once a day, it gets Greater Restoration. It has more shit beyond that. But that is what it can do just to heal and buff your party with healing shit, right, and protection. That's huge, right? This is worth the 7th level spell slot.
Yeah, I'd agree.
The Dryad, maybe. That's circumstantial. This, to me, getting a CR4 creature in there, especially because it's got 13 d8 plus 39 hit points and an AC of 19.
So this thing's, it could stick around for a little while.
Yeah, it's gonna do, like, it's got poison attack, it can constrict things, it's a shape changer, it just magically polymorphs as an action, right? It doesn't cast it, it just does it.
Yep.
Right? Like, there's a lot going for this, but this is a great way to keep your party up and running. If you are a cleric, for some reason you've chosen not to get high-level healing spells, or you want a greater variety of what you have, you took Healing Word, but you didn't take Cure Wounds, this is not a bad option to get that added to the party.
And how long this lasts?
This lasts, I believe, it's up to an hour, but with concentration. So you're not blowing your spiritual guardians for this, yeah. Right? So, or your spirit guardians.
Yeah, you're doing this before the big fight that you know you're just going to be slinging healing spells around, right?
Yeah.
And you know you're going to need that little bit of assistance.
Yeah. So this is what you want, a flyer in the party for whatever reason, mm-hmm. right?
Yeah.
I think this is a really interesting but a little fucky, and it requires timing, but this is a weird option
cool.
that can lead to healing. So the next area that we have, we're going to roll again. For initiative, is the protection from undeath, specifically. So, you have died, but...
Yeah, okay.
All right.
I rolled a natural 1.
I got a 14. I'm just going first in all of this.
Apparently.
So, this is in Xanathar's. So, the very first one is called Ceremony. It's a first level abjuration. It's for clerics and paladins. This one is a ritual. We haven't had a whole lot of rituals so far.
No, we really haven't.
What it does is it protects you from being turned undead, which means that once you've turned undead, you cannot be resurrected,
mm-hmm.
right? So this is, I've died, I've lost my death saves, but we're gonna keep my character in it, maybe, I hope, but it takes an hour to cast.
Oh, geez.
You have to be able to touch the person. Okay, and there are a number of different things that you can do with it.
So if they get incinerated, no luck.
Yeah, look, you can help someone atone for things. You can bless water, and this is how you create holy water.
Yeah.
Right? There's a coming of age ceremony involved.
Makes sense for a first level spell.
Yep. So there's a funeral rite where you touch one corpse. And for the next 7 days, the target can't become undead by any means short of a wish spell.
That's pretty nuts for a first level spell.
Now, you are still freaking rotting. Revivify is not going to then bring you forth, but True Resurrection might. Right? If you're fighting a necromancer and you need to get your dead friend back home, this is how you do it, without them becoming a zombie.
Yeah.
Right? The other thing is there's a dedication where you touch one humanoid who wishes to be dedicated to your god's service, and for the next 24 hours, whenever it makes a saving throw, it rolls a d4 and adds a number to the save. So there's actually kind of an additional bonus as well if you cast it a second time. You can only do one of these.
Mm-hmm.
But you can either kind of help against saving throws or, oh shit, you're dead. I will bring you back after the fact. I will bring your body back and maybe we can resurrect you.
Yeah. You're really hampered by the minute time. Or the hour long.
Well, it means that you're like I say,
you're not doing this for a creature in the middle of death saves.
This is a first level spell.
Yeah.
This is not for you to cast Revivify and get them back up and running. This is for you saying, oh man, this is session one, right? And that character that we really liked, that someone was really excited to play, just went down because the Bullywug crit.
Yep.
All right, I'm going to cast Ceremony. We're going to bring him back and find our patron wizard that sent us on the quest, and he's going to cast whatever it is, right? There will be the cleric in the temple that just once can bring someone back from the dead.
Is this concentration?
It is.
Okay.
No, I'm sorry. It's not concentration. You cast it. It's instantaneous what happens.
Okay.
Right? But it takes an hour, or it's a ritual. And while it is for clerics and paladins, only clerics are ritual casters. So a paladin has to use the spell slot to do it. A cleric can choose to add 10 minutes to the 1 hour casting time, and then they don't use a spell slot, which we're talking about a body for 7 days. I don't think it freaking matters.
Yeah, that's right. Enough.
So
yeah.
I don't see a cleric ever using a spell slot on this.
No.
They do have to have it prepared. Right, but they don't have to use the spell slot.
If you think it's kind of weird that paladins and other classes don't get ritual casting, there is a feat you can take that will open that up to you. So look at that if you want to have that ability as well.
Is it called Ritual Caster?
It's called Ritual Caster.
Wow, I wonder what it does.
Next on the list is Gentle Repose, which is a second level necromancy spell that is also a ritual. But its standard time is an action. And it's verbal somatic, and you have to have a pinch of salt, one copper piece placed on each of the corpse's eyes, which must remain there for the duration of 10 days. So these copper have to stay on the eyes for the 10 days or the spell's not going to work. That's a massive thing. Gentle repose just isn't a hand wave and you're good.
Well then.
Yeah, right?
Everyone's playing that wrong.
So what you do is you touch a corpse or other remains for the duration. The target is protected from decay and cannot become undead.
Assuming that when the copper comes off their eyes...
Everything starts back up.
It starts back up. How long does it take to cast again?
It is an action.
Okay. So you just have to run over and drop pennies on somebody's eyes.
Yeah, and it's copper. Everyone's got copper.
Yeah.
Right? The spell also effectively extends the time limit on raising the target from the dead, since days spent under the influence of the spell don't count against the time limit of spells such as Raise Dead. So basically, you could restart your timer. So if there's going to be a certain amount of time before you die, cast or before you can't raise dead anymore, you cast Gentle Repose, that time limit extends. Pretty simple. This is available to clerics and wizards.
Yeah. I like it.
Yeah.
Okay. The last one on this list, the protection from undeath, is Hallow. Not hollow. Hallow. As in hallowed ground. So the idea, this casting time takes 24 hours. You will be exhausted at the end of this.
And 10 minutes if you do it as a ritual. Is it a ritual?
It is not a ritual.
Okay,
it
so 24 hours.
The duration is until dispelled. And it's fifth level, and it's going to take about 100 gold pieces, which of shit that gets consumed. Not literal shit. You all right there?
Yeah, I'm good.
Okay. The idea is you touch a point and infuse an area around it with a holy or unholy power. The area can have a radius up to 60 feet, and a spell fails if the radius includes an area already under the effect of a hallow spell. The affected area is subject to the following effects. Blah, blah, blah. Celestials, elementals, fey, fiends, and undead can't enter.
Celestials, that's weird.
Yeah, because it can be unholy as well.
Oh, okay, cool.
So what you're doing is you're just imbuing it with your god, not necessarily lawful, good, aligned celestial creatures, right?
Cool, yeah.
This really kind of harkens the idea that angels are not divine in 5th edition.
Okay.
Right. They're from the positive planes, and they often have a god they follow, but they are not inherently divine.
Okay.
So I know it's a splitting hairs, but I guess it fucking matters for this.
Apparently.
Also, anyone in this area is no longer charmed, frightened, or possessed, which is big, because if you're possessed, this is your anti, like, if you need to exorcise someone, then this is the way to do it, if you have 24 hours. Second, you can bind an extra effect to the area, including one of the following, talk to your DM, blah, blah, blah. There's courage, darkness, daylight, energy protection, energy vulnerability, extra dimensional interference, which means they can't move or travel with teleportation, fear, silence, or tongues. All of this is pretty straightforward.
Yeah.
Right? None of that's confusing, but also on that list is everlasting rest. Dead bodies interred in this area can't be turned into undead. So, if someone dies and you have 24 hours, you can bury them here and their body, while it will rot, will not turn into the undead, which means you can come back with your big resurrection spells, your ninth level resurrection magic, and bring them back to life.
Exactly.
Which is big, right?
Yeah, it's fantastic. I really like Hallow. Especially like you set this up in your character's home base. Because it lasts forever.
Yep. And there's all sorts of different options. This is a really versatile spell, but this is the one that applies to healing.
Exactly.
So let's talk about the actual resurrection magic next.
Yep.
Let's roll for it, Daniel.
14.
15. You can't win. I think we did this with like 16, 17 earlier. First and foremost, for resurrection spell, the one we've all been waiting for, coming in from the left, everyone's super excited about, fucking Revivify.
I love Revivify. I hate it.
I hate it. It's Revivify is why bother? Why bother having monsters?
I don't know.
Revivify takes the scary aspect out of the game too early. You get this at 5th level. It is a 3rd level necromancy spell, and it is available to clerics and paladins, but it just takes the fright out of it.
It's got a high cost to cast the spell each time you do it.
300 gold pieces. That's not that much.
If at 5th level, that's a lot for a 5th level character.
Yeah, but
and it's worth of diamonds. You got to make sure your party has these on hand to cast the spell.
I have still seen, like, the people have this. This is not blowing my mind here, right? You touch a creature that has died. It's instantaneous. Takes an action. As long as they died within the last minute, that creature returns to life with 1 hit point.
I don't know, man. Like, the cost plus the time limit makes this make sense to me. Like, I'm okay with it. As a 3rd level spell, they're on par with your fireballs. Like, I'm okay with this. It's got a huge cost. It's what? The most expensive 3rd level spell to cast.
Yep. It's still available at 5th level. And there are... The economy is very strange in Dungeons & Dragons. People get more loot faster than... There's nothing to spend loot on once you have your armor and weapons. Right? Oh, I got a mount. I have a wagon. We bought a keep. But that's it, right? You're not tracking how much gold you spent on ale at the tavern after about tier 1.
Some parties are.
Man, come on. By the time that you're casting Revivify, it doesn't fucking matter. Right.
Well, and you have to think, like, there's also a lot of really cool wondrous magic items out there that you could be saving up for and buying. Like, there's a lot of point in cost. Now, the way they've built 5th edition is magic items mean more for what they have, right? Like, they're not just part of the build anymore.
Right, but the economy is wonky, and so a lot of people hand wave it, is my point. Therefore, I believe that Revivify gets used more often than it should because of the imprecise economy rules.
Sure. So I would encourage any dungeon master running this, make it clear to your players that they have to clear it with you and make sure everyone is aware that they have 300 gold worth of diamonds. And if they don't, then they can't just be like, oh yeah, I prepped this spell, I'm casting it. Do you have the 300 gold worth of diamonds? You don't? Well, then you don't cast it. And now you're screwed, right? Like, there's a huge cost to this. And yeah, sure, later levels, something dies within a minute, you could pop them back up again. Sure. There are rules out there, like in the Tal'Dorei guide, which twist how resurrection magic happens. I would take a look into that as well to see things like what kind of ritual? You have to, like, convince the soul to come back to the body. What kind of thing do you have to do for that? Now, Revivify is kind of hand-wave and it's done, but there, you as a DM can add a lot of weight to that death.
It just feels so overpowered.
Like, what I would do, and I don't know if this is a rule or not, but I would say if someone dies, doesn't matter when they come back, they are coming back exhausted. They come back with two levels of exhaustion, and it takes a day each time to get that done. If you die in the middle of combat and you are brought back, that bringing back aspect is so taxing, you are now at two levels of exhaustion.
Sure, I'm with you, but that wears off in a day and a half, right?
Like, true, but that adds a lot more consequence to a third level spell that costs 100 gold per level in it, right? Like a 300 gold spell.
I don't know, man. It still seems overpowered. If you're going to put that many restrictions on it, make it a fifth level spell. Why is it there at third level?
Because there's no other option until fifth.
I'm cool with that.
I'm not. Because fifth level is, you get fifth level when ninth level. So I'm okay with Revivify. It's one of those spells, you either love it or you hate it. I love it.
I know you hate it. Yeah.
So
we're not going to agree.
No.
All right, what do we have next?
Next, we have Greater Restoration, which is weird that this is on the Resurrection list, but hear me out here. It's a fifth level abjuration spell.
You'll notice Lesser Restoration is not included.
Yes, Lesser Restoration doesn't do what Greater Restoration can do.
Right, because it's greater, yeah.
What you need for Greater Restoration is a diamond dust worth at least 100 gold, which the spell consumes.
Oh, that's so much less than a freaking revive. No, I'm done.
Yeah.
Keep going.
Greater Restoration. The way it brings someone back from the dead is if you count petrification as death.
Yeah.
Greater Restoration brings someone back from petrification.
And I don't consider it's a condition. I don't consider it death.
I don't consider it death either.
Okay. If you smash it and then bring them back up, well, now they're in pieces and they will die. I'm going to give you death saves on that. You come back, gasp, scream in horror, and then just you are snuffed out.
Yeah.
Right? You are in pieces. But
Greater Restoration also removes a charmed effect or removes a curse or a any reduction to a ability score and anything affecting a person's hit point maximum. Like it fixes a lot of it. It's like a reset button for your character. And we included it on this list because it removes petrification.
Yep. And so that's powerful. Bard, Cleric, and Druid. It's odd that you're not going to see this for a Paladin. And I feel like Greater Restoration, because it's conditional, I would even feel comfortable with this on a Wizard list.
Yeah, I guess for an Abjuration Wizard list, yeah. That makes sense. But we've also already discussed how we think Abjuration Wizards should get access to Cure Wounds.
Yeah.
Right? So.
Yeah, all right.
Makes sense for me.
What's next? I don't have anything else on that. That one's pretty straightforward. Next is Raise Dead. I wonder what this one does. Fifth level Necromancy. This one is for Bard, Cleric, and Paladin. Okay? And this one essentially, I'm just going to break it down really quickly. This is not raising zombies. This is you return a dead creature you touch to life as long as it's not been dead longer than 10 days. Okay? It neutralizes poisons. It cures non-magical diseases, specifically non-magical diseases. It doesn't remove magical diseases, curses, or similar effects. So it cannot return an undead creature to life, but it closes all mortal wounds, but it doesn't restore missing body parts. That's what you need your Greater Restoration ship for, right? So,
Regenerate?
Here's a neat thing. Coming back from the dead is an ordeal. The target takes a -4 penalty to all attack rolls, saving throws, and ability checks. And every time the target finishes a long rest, that penalty is reduced by 1 until it disappears.
Revivify should have that too.
There we go. And then I'm fine with it, right? The fact that Revivify is, no, you're good. I feel like it's CPR.
Well, it's like your dead character didn't get far enough away from the space between the veil, so doesn't have any negative effect.
Yeah, the ghost is still just like hanging around the room, like, guys, help.
Yeah, it's like still just sitting up and like pulling itself out of the body and looking around and realizing it's dead, and then you just slam it back in the body. Okay, I think there should be some sort of mechanical negative persisting after death.
I'll give them a sanity stat.
you should be giving your party members and your players sanity stats anyways.
It's no, so that's a variant rule. Anyway, that's not the point. What do we have going on next?
Next, we have Reincarnate, which is available to
druids only. It's fucking weird.
I love it. I've seen it exploited in previous editions.
I think as long as you're rolling randomly, and I would expand the table. We'll get into it in a second, but expand the table to include the Volos monsters as well.
Yep.
Or the Volos races. So anyways, what does it do?
So it is a casting time of an hour as a fifth level transmutation spell. You need rare oils and ungots worth at least 1,000 gold, which the spell consumes. And what you do is you touch a dead humanoid or a piece of the dead humanoid.
I love that.
If you only have an ear, you're good.
I have hair, right? Yeah. Like I have this guy's hair.
Which
I only have the dwarf's beard.
If we have a druid in the party, he just has a little bag full of hair locks with him, just in case, right? Everyone just cuts off a lock of the hair he tied up and he carries
it. I love that this is druid only.
I also love that it's druid only. So, provided that the creature hasn't been dead for any longer than 10 days, what you can do is it forms them a new adult body, which the soul then inhabits.
So, but the fun part is the DM gets to roll a D100 percentile dice.
Not the player.
Yeah, to find out which race that body is going to be.
Yeah.
And it's Dragonborn, the different dwarves, the different elves, the different gnomes, the different half elf, half orc, the two halflings, a human or a tiefling. I will have you notice it's not a variant human.
Mm-hmm.
That was not on the list. But the other thing that I like about this as well is that it is like, oh, what gender are you going to be when you come back?
I find it weird that it's tiefling, but not Aesmar. But that's because Aesmar wasn't out yet.
Yeah.
Okay.
You're right. So this is just the ones in the player's handbook.
So you should really bring in like Aesmar and Goliath and Minotaur. Like bring in the Ravnica ones. Change the math as you need.
Right. Yeah, at this point, they're all, I don't know, roughly between 4 and 7% chance of getting it. It's more difficult to become a Dragonborn or a Tiefling. It's pretty common to become
a human. Look at that gap on the human.
Oh, yeah.
19%.
Yeah.
Where they have a 1/5 chance to become a human.
Whereas, you know, the gnome, it's 43 to 46 on a percentile, but it's also 47, 52 because there are two different kinds of gnomes involved. Yeah. So I would totally just play with this. And if you were like, you know what? I would like to give them the opportunity to be a Svirfneblin.
Yep.
As well. Then I'll give them some funky stats and I'll add it to the list. I feel like this encourages DM tinkering.
Yeah, it does. I also love that when you reincarnate somebody, they retain all of their knowledge and all of their experience in their former life. The only thing you basically reset is their race traits and their racial traits.
Yep, but I also desperately want to change their gender as well.
I'd say it's a 50-50. You roll it.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, absolutely. You flip a coin on this one.
And that is something you clear with your players, of course, before you do it.
Do you?
Yes.
Okay, fine.
Yes, you do.
All right. The next one on the list is Resurrection.
Gee, I wonder what it does.
Huh.
So while we're talking about resurrection magic, what does resurrection do?
It's a 7th level necromancy spell. It's available for the bard and the cleric. It's weird. Again, it feels...
It's because paladins don't get 7th level spells.
No, but I was going to say, I feel like it needs to be on a wizard list. You're freaking playing with the arcane. A wizard should be able to learn how to resurrect someone, especially a necromancer.
Yeah, that's fair.
Anyway, beside the point. This costs an hour to cast. You have to be able to touch your target, but it is instantaneous. You're spending a diamond worth at least 1,000 gold pieces, which gets consumed, but that's standard. It's all diamonds for resurrection, right? Like, that's the thing. So, players, if your DM says, oh, you came upon a diamond mine, loot the shit out of that.
Everything. Make a camp. So, you're there now for a couple months.
There's actually random tables in the DMG, which encourages you to like roll to see which gems you're getting. Ask if diamonds are a part of it and roll percentile dice to see how many diamonds you get.
I'm actually not a huge fan of how much diamonds are required. I would love to see other forms of gems because then everything just becomes diamonds.
There are for other magics. There are topazes and rubies and other things.
I get it. I would still try to have like... Or just precious gems up to another 50% of the cost or whatever it is, right?
Sure, yeah. Well, there's some of that. It's around, but it's not, you're right, it's not as prevalent as diamonds. Anyway, you touch a dead creature that's been dead for no more than a century.
That it, eh?
Yep.
Move quick.
And it didn't die of old age. And it can't be undead. and its soul has to be free and willing. And then it returns with all of its hit points.
Cool.
Okay, so again, we're neutralizing poisons and diseases. We're getting rid of, but only basic diseases. It's not going to remove magical diseases, curses, stuff like that. So you get that -4 penalty to all attack rolls, saving throws, and ability checks, which reduces after every long rest again. And here's my favorite bit. Casting this spell to restore life to a creature that has been dead for 1 year or longer taxes you greatly. Until you finish a long rest, you cannot cast spells. You have disadvantage on all attack rolls, ability checks, and saving throws.
Yikes.
This feels like exhaustion 4.5, right? The 4.5 level of exhaustion.
Yeah.
Right? This hurts. So if you're going to do this, you need help from your party.
Yeah. And you need a rest. Like, this is not a, we need to resurrect this guy and give him, like, and then we'll leave immediately to go fight the dragon. No. This is, we resurrect and we give him some time. We'll see you in a week, bud. You go sleep. We'll bring up some chicken noodle soup when you need
it. Yeah, especially when you're playing with the long rest rules, where a short rest is a day and a long rest is a week.
Yep.
Or a month. I've seen that as well. That's crippling.
Yes.
Crippling. Anyway, what do we have next on the list?
Next we have Clone.
This is my favorite thing for NPCs and bad guys.
8th level necromancy spell.
I love it.
Castable by clerics. Sorry, by only wizards.
Yep.
Only wizards get this one. Casting time of an hour. You need two things with this. Three things, really, with it. You need a diamond worth 1,000 gold.
Sure.
You need a container large enough to hold a medium-sized creature worth at least 2,000 gold.
So you need a freaking sarcophagus.
You need a Bacta tank. Yes.
Okay, nerd. I said sarcophagus. I'm thinking, like, yeah. I love the idea of you step out of the golden sarcophagus in the pyramid.
I like the options it gives you as examples. A huge urn, a coffin, a mud-filled cyst in the ground, which is the grossest sentence I've heard yet today.
I love that. That takes me to, like, the classic comic book Ra's al Ghul.
Yeah.
Right? Where he's coming up from the wells of life. He's just, like, appearing. Like he's died, they put his husk in it, and then he stands up again.
I also kind of get the image of the orcs and goblins from Lord of the Rings, from the Lord of the Rings movies.
Yeah, yeah.
When they're pulling like that film, that skin off.
It's Neo waking up inside in the real world, right?
Exactly, yeah. Another option is a crystal container filled with salt water.
Wah, wah.
Yeah, right, that makes sense. But the third thing you need is 1 cubic inch of flesh of the creature that's supposed to be cloned. Cubic inch.
That is not a square inch. That is a cubic inch. That shit's gonna leave a puckered scar.
That's gonna leave a mark.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So I just see the one necromancer with this thing just like, all right, got my diamond. I've got my gem. Oh, this is the part I don't like. Stabs himself in the gut with a thing.
I'm picturing him like biting down on a leather belt as Igor is just like carving it out of his buttock.
Oh, ouch.
And when it's done, he's like, master, I have it done. He just turns around and just decks him in the face. Oh!
And like Igor holds up a 3 cubic inch piece of meat.
Right.
You're like, too much. You took too much.
Well, I need 2 more earthen cysts.
So what this spell does is the creature, you put this little chunk of flesh in this container and you cast this spell over it. And what it does is the spell grows an inert duplicate of the caster.
But there's no soul. There's no mind.
There's no soul. There's no mind. It's just a
waiting.
Husk,
yeah.
Right. It takes forms within the sealed vessel and takes 120 days to reach maturity. Once it reaches maturity, it remains inert until the caster dies. At that point, the soul transfers directly into the clone, assuming the soul is willing to return.
Yeah.
Right? Then the clone is physically identical to the original, has the same personality memories, but none of the original's equipment because it wasn't there.
Yeah, it's not the body, right? Yeah.
But you remember everything and you have the same experience level of your previous form.
All right. Oh, sorry, is there more?
The original creature's physical remains, if they still exist, then become inert and can't be raised to life.
Of course, your soul can only be in one place. That's fine. And I love the idea of the fact that you're shrugging off like your scars and stuff too. So this new clone body does not have that missing cubic flesh.
Until they get out and be like, all right, well, open up this drawer where there's another diamond and then turn back around to the cyst. Igor. They're still like covered in goop and naked and just here we go.
I feel like the first time that this happens, the necromancer turns to Igor and says, kill me. Hack up all of this flesh and put my soul inside the first one. But there's just like 15 different like sarcophagi or tanks or whatever lined up there, ready to go. So sidebar, I have a recurring character. He is the villain that is consistently harassing the party in my Tuesday campaign. And he has a number of clones, but he has the number 6 carved on his head. And they're all level 6 right now. So he just showed up and they murdered him. And they all got a vision of him stepping out of a sarcophagus with the number 7 carved in and going, all right, fine, I will use this wand then. And he picks up a more powerful wand and says, where are they? And then stomps off into the darkness, right? And every level, they're going to have to fight and kill this guy, and he's going to come back stronger than the last.
That's fantastic.
And so their mission is to burn this fucking place down so there's no more sarcophagus, right? So that's...
Well, and like, this is a 8th level necromancy spell. Yeah. You are level 13, 15 when you get access to this?
See, the other thing that I really like about this is this feels mind flayery to me as well.
It does. It feels like... Top end, this is your big bad evil guy for the campaign. And he's just got these things strewn about everywhere in safe houses across this entire realm. And he just jumps
you
from
need,
each one.
You need Soul Cage to stop this.
You need Soul Cage to stop this. Okay, what's all next? Right.
So what we have next is our 9th level. This is our big one. True Resurrection. It's another necromancy, obviously. Clerics or druids get this. And instead of it being 1 century, it's 200 years. It's 2 centuries. Right? It takes an hour to cast. You need holy water, just a little bit, and 25,000 gold pieces worth of diamonds.
That's it, hey?
That's it.
Just 25,000 gold worth of diamonds?
At level, like, this is a 9th level spell. You're level, what, 18?
25,000 gold is a lot. No matter what your level is.
Not when you're killing dragons and taking their hordes.
True. Or casting Wish. Which gives you 25,000 gold worth of whatever you want.
Yep. So anyway, you touch a creature that's been dead for no longer than 200 years. If it died of old age, it doesn't count. I like that that is a constant here, right?
Yep.
And it's got to be free and willing. It's the same thing. It closes all wounds. But this one does lift any curse affecting it. It cures all diseases, including magical. And it replaces damaged and missing organs and limbs, right? If the creature was undead, it restores it to its non-undead form. This is the only one that can flip an undead.
Wow.
Okay? The spell can even provide a new body if the original no longer exists. In which case, you must speak the original creature's name as part of your verbal. The creature then appears in an unoccupied space you choose within 10 feet of you. So this is just... You summoning Imhotep, right, from the reaches of history, and then he just appears.
This is the lightning bolt coming down and a naked Arnold Schwarzenegger standing up slowly.
Exactly, right? This is just
dun,
like...
Dun, 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 dun.
you know who I really need was that character that I... The player character that died at level 4, but he had this piece of information. We just got to ask him a question. Boom!
I do have one question. A lot of these resurrection spells say... Won't work if the soul's not willing. Is there a way to like force someone to be resurrected?
Yes. I would say yes based on the fiend stuff, because your options are to cross the River Styx and become either a Lemur or a Manus, right?
Yeah.
So, like, or you can come back into your body, right? So if they're like, no, I don't want to come back, be like, well, bitch, we're going to drop you in the 9 hells. We're going to drop you in Gehenna. Right.
So it requires a lot of extra, like, actually role playing and everything else. It's not just a, like, I was wondering if there's like a spell. It's like, regardless of whether the soul wants to or not, it's now in that.
No. That's, I mean, Soul Cage.
Yeah, but that's like a reaction as soon as something dies. If you wait around, you can't do it.
Yeah, look, there's all sorts of speak with undead level stuff, too, that's not this episode.
Yeah.
Right? So you may be able to coerce things, but a lot of the times they're just answering yes or no questions and stuff.
Fair enough. Yeah, so, okay, cool.
That's DM discretion is cool. What I would
what
say.
What do we got next?
Undeath.
Let's roll for it.
I finally rolled a 1.
I rolled a 3.
I mean, you're not doing well, but I feel like I gave you a gimme on this one.
Yeah, okay. So first one of undeath. This is, of course, if you... want someone to be back, but you don't necessarily need them to be themselves. Here's what you do.
Yeah, so this is when you have the necromancer in the party. So we're talking about specifically creating undead creatures.
Yeah.
And this is kind of, you know what? I really liked having this guy around.
Yeah.
And I don't want him to go yet. No. So here we go.
So Animate Dead is a third level necromancy spell. It is available to clerics and wizards both respectively. It's a 1 minute casting time, not a ritual. Which I find weird.
No, I'm fine with it. You got to cast it right now. You don't get to... Oh.
Yeah.
You have Create Undead later, so I think that's where...
Okay, cool. You need a drop of blood, a piece of flesh, and a pinch of bone dust. So you need, like, the material bits of what creates a thing, right? And what this spell does is it creates an undead servant. Choose a pile of bones... or a corpse, and the spell fills the target with a foul, I love how it says, a foul mimicry of life, raising it as an undead creature. The target becomes a skeleton if you choose bones, or a zombie if you choose a corpse. So again, listen back to our mob mentality episode, I think it was episode 36. On skeletons and zombies.
It was the last episode.
Yeah, it was the last one we recorded. On each of your turns, as a bonus action, you then mentally command this creature to do things as long as it's within 60 feet of you.
That's pretty standard for zombie stuff.
Yeah. And so it could do pretty much anything a zombie or skeleton could do. But after 24 hours, it stops obeying your commands. But in order to maintain control of the creature for another 24 hours, you got to cast the spell again for another 24 hours. So you have to re-up it. Okay. The use of the spell reasserts your control for up to 4 creatures you have animated with the spell. So you can have multiple creatures, with this thing. And then if you use the spell, with a 4th level or higher spell slot, you get to animate additional creatures as you go. So there's a lot to this one. You're creating skeletons and zombies as a horde for you.
It's not a super powered horde though. You're not getting thousands.
No, but they can last days. And I mean, you cast this as a 9th level spell. You're getting 8 minions right out the gate.
Yep,
I love it.
I don't know. That's kind of weak for a 9th level spell slot.
Wait.
But...
Is it? Oh, 2 additional for each spell level.
Yeah,
above 4th. So that's 4th. 5th, 6th, 7th, 8th, you're getting 10 more on top of the original one. So you're getting 11 things with each casting of this. 11 creatures of zombies that...
It's not concentration?
Not concentration. And they last 24 hours and you just control them mentally.
Can you only control one at a time?
Nope.
Do you use an action to command?
It is a bonus action to command any creature within 60 feet of you.
And you decide
what the action the creature will take and where it will go during its turn or what it will do for a general command.
Right. So what I would have to do if I've got, say, 11 of these things, I would then spend the next 11 rounds using my bonus actions to be like, your general command is to do whatever I say. And then you can say, attack that guy, right? Instead of saying, attack, because only one will do it, because you can only target one.
I would say this is something, because it's a minute-long casting, you're casting it before combat, and you're just assuming that your guy did that. So then when it comes down to combat, and he's got these 11
I'm not assuming that, because 11 bonus actions is another minute, so that's 2 minutes to do it.
Yeah.
Like, I need the player to do it.
Well, the player would you have to clear that with your player as a DM, or players, you have to clear it with your DM, that I'm casting the spell, I'm raising 11 skeletons, and I'm also going to spend that additional minute to tell them, hey, here's what you have to do, so that I can command them all as a bonus action still, but it will affect all of them.
Yeah. And well, no, because then anything you say, it's an interaction, and they will do what you say because you've spent the bonus action to do it.
Sure.
Point is that you can't say get that one or you can say get that one and they'll all turn, but you can't issue a new command like ignore what I said. Or, like, resets everything.
Yeah.
So,
the thing I like the most about this thing is it is a ninth level spell. You could cast it as a ninth level spell with no component, and you just keep re-upping them. So, these skeletons and zombies will stay with you as long as you have the spell slots to do it.
Right. So, here's a fifth level spell, okay? This is in Xanathar's. It's necromancy. It's for warlocks and wizards, and it's called the Dance Macabre.
I love it.
I love it to a point. It feels underpowered to me. One action, 60-foot range again. It's the very same thing, except dark threads of power leap from your fingers to pierce up to 5 small or medium creatures you can see. So you're getting more right off the bat, right? You decide whether it's a zombie or a skeleton. I love the idea of you choosing it's a skeleton and the bones just tear free of the flesh.
Gross.
Right? But it's any corpse. There's no limit on how long it's been dead.
I think I've seen that in a Hellraiser movie.
Oh, could be. But here's the great thing is they gain a bonus to their attack and damage rolls equal to your spellcasting ability modifier. That's not a replacement. That is an addition. So these things super hit.
I love it.
Yep.
Is at what level?
It's fifth level. But
so, yeah, they're getting a 5.
Right, but here's the thing. It's the same way to get them to follow commands and within 60 feet and all that nonsense.
Is it the spellcasting modifier or the spellcasting ability modifier?
Spellcasting ability modifier.
Okay. If it was just spellcasting modifier, then that includes your proficiency.
Yeah, no. it's not your spellcast or your attack number. It's your... it's your ability check. So
cool.
For wizards, it's intelligence. And for warlocks, it's warlocks, it's charisma.
Okay, cool.
So it's the same rules about giving them orders and all that, but the creatures are under your control until the spell ends, which only lasts an hour, and it requires your concentration.
Cool.
Okay. At higher spell slots, they become, or you get 2 more for every beyond that. But you're starting off with 5 at fifth level. Right, so you can have, what is that, an additional 8, so you're up to 13, mm-hmm. but you only get them for an hour.
Yeah.
And you have to maintain your concentration, and at the end, they become inanimate objects again. They just fall down.
Cool.
So, that's that. We got one more in the Undeath, Dan.
Create Undead, which is a 6th level a necromancy spell. It takes a minute to cast, and you can only cast it at night, which bum, I like.
Bum.
Super edgelordy. It's fantastic. It's verbal, somatic, and the material component on this one is a clay pot filled with grave dirt, 1 clay pot filled with brackish water, and 1 150 gold black onyx stone for each corpse you raise.
Do you know what brackish water is?
Old water.
No. No. As someone who had fish tanks, brackish water is not just old water. It is halfway between fresh water and salt water. There is a high salt content, but it is still able to, you can still drink it. It's just not going to taste good.
Okay.
All right. So brackish water, think kind of like brine.
Okay. Yeah, cool. I'm with you. So what this does is for each corpse, you need 150 gold thing, and you could do up to 3 corpses. So this could cost you up to 450 gold.
Now, when you say I can do up to 3 corpses.
Not that way, Adam.
Gross, Dan.
Yeah.
You're gross.
Yeah, you're the one that brought it up.
Bro. Dan, you're gross.
So choose up to 3 corpses of medium or small humanoids. You can't do a large one with this.
Still gross.
And each corpse becomes a ghoul under your command. Specifically a ghoul.
That's fun.
Okay. And we'll talk about ghouls in a minute because what they do, like they're intelligent creatures.
Yeah.
For the most part. So you can still talk to these guys. So as a bonus action on each of your turns, you commit to the command any creature you animated within the spell that as long as it's 120 feet of within 120 feet of you.
That's so much more powerful than the 60-foot radius of the others.
It's also a 6th level spell.
Well, I mean, it's a 5th level spell. It only gives you like...
Fair enough.
You're doubling for one
So level. You decide what action the creature takes and where it will move. And if you issue no commands to it at all, it'll defend itself against hostile creatures.
That's standard. I've been skipping over that, but yeah. That's true for all of them.
Once it's given an order, it will continue to follow it until it's complete. So even if you walk out of this 120-foot range, it will continue to do it. So if you say, break down that wall and you walk away, it will keep going until it is either destroyed or it breaks down the wall. Now, the creature is under your control for 24 hours, at which point it stops obeying your orders. To maintain control, you must cast the spell on the creature again to maintain the 24-hour duration. This use of the spell asserts your control over up to the three creatures you've animated with the spell, rather than animating new ones. Now, if you want to spend additional spell slots, per spell slot you spend, you get an additional, you get a bunch of stuff. So at 7th level, if you use a 7th level spell slot to go, you get 4 ghouls. If you use an 8th level spell slot, you get 5 ghouls or 2 ghasts or wights.
Shit.
And when you use a 9th level, you can animate to have 6 ghouls, 3 ghasts or wights, or 2 mummies.
Mummies are powerful, but they're not... I would still take the ghouls. And here's why. I'm just going to touch really quickly on what a ghoul is, because this is not a monster episode, right?
Yeah.
But they've got an intelligence of 7, a wisdom of 10, and a charisma of 6, which means these are thinking creatures. They eat flesh, right? They're like maggots and carrion beetles. They want decay and dead flesh, not living flesh. So they want to kill you first, okay? They bite, and they claw, and their claw attack paralyzes on a DC 10 constitution.
Not elves. Specifically says in there, not
elves. Yes, not elves. So
this is where the elves being resistant to paralyzation comes in, because it's not under the elf feature. It's specifically in the ghoul's paralyzation feature, which is weird.
Yeah. Well, it's because the original ghoul was Dorsain, where he was an elf who was twisted by the abyss. And the Orcus like fucked with him,
yeah.
Right? And then so he was an elf originally, and he turned on his the other of his kind, right? So it's in the lore if you read it. But ghasts are superpowered ghouls. Wights have armor and are even more badass.
Yeah,
right. Like
I would take 3 ghasts over 6 ghouls.
I would take 3 ghasts over 6 ghouls. I would. Well, I mean, action economy depends on who you're fighting.
I guess that's true.
So anyway. I really like that. That's fun. But that's the end of our undeath.
Yeah.
So this is how you keep your characters, kind of.
Sort
of. Right? And now let's get to the weird fucky shit about staving off death.
Okay? Yeah, let's do it.
So let's roll. I rolled a nat 20, Dan.
And I botched.
And you got a nat 1. My God, it's like real life.
Note how I deliberately try to not hit your dice with the nat 20.
Yeah.
You're welcome for that.
I appreciate that, Dan.
Yeah.
But I don't need your fucking charity. So,
how about you give me the book?
All right. So the very first one here is the 3rd level necromantic spell, Vampiric Touch. This is for warlocks and wizards only. You find it in the PHB. Here's the thing about Vampiric Touch. This will not work if you are already unconscious.
Yeah.
Because it takes 1 action to cast on yourself and requires concentration up to a minute. And the idea is you make a melee attack. You're casting magic, but you have to touch the person. And on a hit, the target takes 3d6 necrotic damage, and you regain hit points equal to half the amount of that damage dealt. Okay, until it ends, you can make the attack again on each of your turns as an action. So you cast this and you have imbued yourself with this life-draining ability. At higher levels, the damage increases 1d6 per spell slot level, right?
Yeah.
So this, if for some reason you are conscious with 0 hit points, if you can somehow make that work, you can bring yourself back into the positive with this.
Yeah.
So this is about regaining hit points at the to the detriment of others. And I would even say that if you have 1 hit point left, you cast this on yourself, reach over and touch the barbarian.
Yeah.
This does not have to be an enemy. This can be an ally. And while you're only going to get half of what they get, their hit die is a
d12. Yours is a d6.
Yeah, you need this, right? Yeah,
for sure.
So I like that this is a bit of a trade-off. This is weird. And we had another one earlier, which was Life Transference, but this one is specifically like necrotic damage that you are doing. I like this one, but it's a little fucky.
Yep. Life Transference did necrotic damage as well, though.
Life transference is you sacrificing your hit points for somebody else. This is you taking someone else's.
Yeah.
Right? So this is the direction of the flow is different.
Cool.
Okay? So vampiric touch. And again, those are both. Life transference and vampiric touch are both third level.
Yep.
So
our next spell in this fucking nonsense level of stuff is a spell I just discovered a few weeks ago, and I love it.
Because you like fucking nonsense, Dan.
Well, also because I play a lot of characters that heavily rely more on their short rest than their long rest. I am talking about Catnap from Xanathar's. Catnap is a third level enchantment spell that is available to bards, sorcerers, and wizards. It takes an action to cast and has a range of 30 feet and requires somatic components and a pinch of sand. Because you don't want to be loud when you're trying to put people to sleep. So there's no verbal. It's a duration of 10 minutes. And what it does is you make a calming gesture. And up to three creatures, willing, of your choice, fall unconscious for 10 minutes. And when they get up, they have the full benefits of a short rest, which standard rules are an hour. This gives you a 10-minute short rest. However, you cannot benefit from the spell again unless you take a long rest. So this is a one and done.
Yep. Okay?
Now, you can boost this with additional spell, higher level spell slots, and for each creature, for each spell slot above third, so fourth or higher, you gain an additional creature that you would knock unconscious with this, up to and including yourself. You could just be like, meh, and you pass out, right? 10 minutes later, you're up with your full catnap. This gives you the ability to have your warlock stand back up with full slots. Your wizard can hit his arcane recovery. Everyone can blow hit dice on heals.
There it is. It's all about the hit dice for the healing on this, right? So
so this gives you a 10-minute short rest.
Yeah, I really like that.
Yeah. And it's a third level spell. It's not that unattainable.
No.
Like your fifth level character is going to have the option to hit this. And yeah, go nuts, I would say. So what do we got next?
All right, next is, there's a lot to this one. This is Glyph of Warding. It's level 3. It's an abjuration. It's for bards, clerics, and wizards. And it's in the player's handbook. Here's the thing. This is not specifically about healing, but what it does do is it stores spells. The idea is that you inscribe a glyph that later unleashes a magical effect. And there's a lot of rules about it.
Yep.
And I'm not going to go through it. The idea is essentially that you create a giant glyph somewhere that's nearly invisible. You have to roll a successful investigation to see it. And if you trigger the glyph, then the spell will trigger.
Yeah.
Which means you can drop anything third level or lower into this. It has to be a spell, specifically not a cantrip. This will not give you Spare the Dying. But it will give you a Healing Word. It will give you Cure Wounds. More importantly, it will give you Revivify if you can cast it.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So this is one of those ones that I feel like you can you put this up just like inside your own keep, just inside the front door. And when you walk in, you can smash your hand on it and 10 good berries land in your hand. Right?
I like that. Yeah.
So, cool. So this is when you are like... Look, it takes an hour to cast, all right? If you don't need the short rest, but the rest of your party does, the monk needs their key points back, the warlock needs his spell slots and whatnot, but you're sitting there going, no, man, fuck you, I'm good. Take the time, throw a Glyph of Warding down, and then you're laughing. If, for example, there's also, you can set it for traps and other things, but if you know that you're going to be defending this position and you have an hour of prep time, you can put down a series of glyphs of warding if you get a bunch of different people doing it all at once to fortify the tower around you with healing spells for archers maybe that are above shooting down.
There are so many uses of this.
Right, and I'm not going to go through all of it. If you want to get into all the offensive stuff, then you can get into it.
A creative player with Glyph of Warding is...
But it doesn't have to be in a location either. You can put it on an object.
You can put it on a book and carry it with you.
Yeah, you can put it on your shield, on the inside of the fighter's shield, right?
Yeah, so all he does is hit the shield, and now he has a floating shield, or he has some other ability, right?
Like there's bam, mage armor, right?
Yeah.
But this, like, I like this. I like it a lot. The only thing, and you can set conditions for it too, right?
Now, when you do this, does this take that spell slot from you permanently?
No. No, no, no. The duration of this is until dispelled or triggered, which means you cast it. It takes an hour to cast.
And this oh my word.
This is what I'm saying. This is what I'm saying.
Yeah. I mentioned it earlier in this episode. My next character is an abjuration wizard.
There you go.
And he's got this, and he's just got like several books that he hangs off of him. And he's like, oh, we're in a fight now. Well, 1 second while I pull up my fight book. And I'm like, all right, well, I'm going to hit this glyph and magic missiles are going to fly off of it. Why? Because I had 2 weeks worth of lead time to this, and I just started dumping spells into books.
I would be, as a DM, I would be very specific about this one. It will cast magic missile at the nearest goblin. This one will cast magic missile at the nearest kobold. So you can use all the prep time you want and put all of your low-level spells you didn't use, like all your spell slots you didn't use, into your spell book for these glyphs and whatnot. But I'm going to ask you to have very specific triggers for them, very specific outcomes of them, because it is just, it casts.
Yeah. What if the spell, I'm reading it here. If the spell requires concentration.
Yep.
You don't have to concentrate it on anymore.
No, because you concentrated during the spell.
Which means you could walk around and you have a spiritual weapon glyph.
Yeah.
For somehow, if you get this spiritual weapon.
Yep.
Spiritual weapon glyph, you hit it. Now you can have two spiritual weapons flying across the field.
Yes, this is insane, is what I'm saying.
I love this spell.
And
this,
nobody uses it.
There are not a lot of. In 5th edition, one thing I've noticed is lacking is scroll creation. This is your scroll creation. It's just a spell itself now.
Yep.
Yeah. So, I like it. And also, you can do explosive runes with it. And explosive runes are always fun to be like, hey, barbarian, read this for a downtime joke.
Right. Like, for a downtime joke, fuck off. All right, what's next? What do we have?
Next, we have...
This is very, very, very similar. But I like it because it's even more go fuck yourself. Yeah, right?
It really is.
And I absolutely love putting this on my enemy NPCs, my big, bad, evil guy.
I have a character who has used this in our current campaign.
All right, well, tell people.
So this is Contingency. It is a 6th level evocation spell. Which, that's a weird school for this. It's got a casting time of 10 minutes, and its range is yourself. You need a small statuette of yourself carved from ivory and decorated with gems of at least 1,500 gold as a material component, and the duration is only 10 days, which is weird. But when you hear what the spell could do, it you'll understand. You choose a spell of 5th level or lower that you can cast... And it has a casting time of an action and can target yourself. You cast that spell called the contingent spell. And as part of the casting contingency, expending the spell slots for both.
All right. So hold on, because you just said a whole bunch of just jargon there. When you decided that you're going to choose cure wounds, for example, because this is about healing.
Yeah.
So you cast this contingency on a item. Or on yourself. And if you set up a trigger that says, if I take 50 damage, then cure wounds triggers on me. But when I cast this, it uses up both spell slots.
Yeah. This is if, you know, in a day or 2 days, you know you're going to be going and doing this offensive fight. You go and you set up a bunch of contingencies. One of my favorite uses of this is Death Ward. You hit yourself with a contingency for Death Ward so that you have Death Ward for the next 10 days.
Yeah, and that's what it's for. But when you cast it, it takes both the spell slot for contingency and the spell slot for Death Ward.
Yeah, right. And then you go and sleep. And then you get those spell slots back, and then you're good.
Right, but that means that there is going to be a finite number of times that you can do this, right? And it's limited on contingency, that spell slot. Right?
It's dependent on how many 6th level spell slots you get per day.
Yeah.
Right? So, I mean, at 20th level, you're getting 3 of them a day.
Yeah.
I think three or four. So at 20th level, you're only doing 3 or 4 of these a day. It's going to hit a big thing. And it's only a 5th level or lower other spells that you're hitting on yourself. So this one, you hit yourself with a cure wounds. And if you said a thing, if I drop below this amount of hit points, cure wounds activates.
Yeah. Now, again, it says spell, right? Not a cantrip. And they're very clear in 5th edition that spells and cantrips are two very different things.
Yeah.
So what's interesting to note here is that this is about spells only. It's not cantrips. You cannot put Spare the Dying on this. 5th edition is very, very, very specific about the fact that cantrips are not spells. Now, whenever you see something that says, like a spell effect or a spell save or anything like that, as far as like shield or or magic or mage armor or whatnot, if it says the word spell in it in the description, you need to be very specific about the fact that this does not include cantrips. So I like this, but you can't just load up a whole shit ton of shillelaghs.
Right? Yeah.
So this could be super powerful. There's not a whole lot of big heals by, what is that?
Fifth level.
Oh, fifth level? Never mind. Yep. Crazy. You're just reanimating dead whenever the fuck you want, right?
Yep.
Like you cast it on yourself.
You can cast Resurrection on yourself.
Resurrection?
Base level Resurrection as a contingency is a fifth level spell.
Good freaking Lord. So this is a thing. Remember I said that Vampiric Touch requires you to be conscious?
Sorry, Resurrection's seventh. You could cast Raise Dead on yourself.
Raise Dead, yeah. But remember I said Vampiric Touch required you had to be conscious because you have to cast the spell in order to gain the benefit of leeching that, right?
Yeah.
Now you don't have to do that. You've cast Contingency upon yourself, so when you drop to zero, you just suck the life from the nearest son of a bitch, right?
Yep.
The guy that knocked you down.
Yep.
So I think that's a lot
of fun. I love it. Yeah, it's lots of fun. It's a lot of paperwork, a lot of stuff to manage, and this is the same with Glyph of Warding. You got to be in active communication with your DM if you're choosing to go with this about the contingencies you have in place. You can't just be like, oh yeah, I set this contingency up before when it's triggered active. That's not okay, man. You got to talk to your DM beforehand and make sure they know.
Yep.
Okay.
Now.
And DMs, don't be the dick that like, I know what the trigger is, so I'm going to very specifically not do that thing.
No, if your players are being creative, reward them for being creative.
Exactly, yeah.
And contingency is a creative spell.
Yeah.
Right? This is going to work really well with like augury, where you can figure out kind of the future and is this a good idea or a bad idea? And
I'm with you. So, what else we got here, Adam?
We have two left. And if you don't mind, Dan, I would like to discuss both of them. I would like to...
Well, fine. Fuck you then.
No, because...
You want me to leave?
The first one is Wish. Wish is a ninth level conjuration. It's infamous because it takes one action you cast on yourself. It's only verbal, and you do whatever you want. Fifth edition is fairly limiting in Wish. It's not as overpowered as it has been in previous editions because it's specific with kind of what you can do, and then talk to your DM about doing similar level things. You are not rewriting all of human history with Wish.
No.
You can create 25,000 gold pieces of value of a non-magical item, specifically non-magical, right? The one that pertains to hit points is you get 20 creatures you can see to regain all their hit points. So as long as you can see them.
Jeez.
Yep. And you end all effects on them described in the Greater Restoration spell.
Just bang, nice. Which right? is everything, including petrification.
Yeah. You grant up to 10 creatures you can see immunity to a single spell or other magical effect for 8 hours. For instance, you can make yourself and all your companions immune to a lich's life drain attack, which means you can make people immune to being turned to undead as well.
For life?
For 8 hours.
Okay.
Right? And you can undo a single recent event by forcing a reroll of any roll made within the last round, which means if someone fails a death save, I don't know why you wouldn't just heal them. But for whatever reason.
Well, no, it's like if the wizard gets off that teleport or something, you can make them reroll the chance dice. Or
right, but I'm talking specifically for healing. Specifically for bringing you back. If they fail their final death save and for some reason you're in an anti-life magic field where healing potions don't work, Wish can still make them reroll that save, right?
Yeah, fair enough.
There's more shit that you can do. And it's really up to the DM's discretion, but this is max kerfuckery, right? I would let you regrow not just limbs, but like your head comes back. You know, you get your head blown off, head comes back, right?
It's a ninth level spell. Like honestly, you're hitting your most powerful ability to do this. It's gotta have some oomph to it.
It does, and so. Look, Wish pisses me off, but I also understand that it's not as detrimental. It's not as game-breaking as it has been.
Yeah, it's far more limited. It's very much like a limited Wish now.
Right? Yeah.
Like, back in 3.5, there was limited Wish and Wish.
Was it limited or was it lesser?
I'm pretty sure it was limited.
Okay.
And I find that 5th edition has done Wish far different than 3.5.
Okay.
All right, so what's this last one here, Adam?
We're talking about mass polymorph, okay? What's interesting here is the wording, because it's not like true polymorph or polymorph. The way that it works for true polymorph and polymorph is, and I'm going to read that out, the spell transforms a creature you can see within range into a new form, blah, blah, blah. It has no effect on Shape Changer or a creature with 0 hit points. When you get transformed, you get the hit points of the new creature, right? And then when you get knocked down from that, you revert to your original hit points.
Okay.
So when you already have hit points, this is like temporary hit points in your new form. But when you're already dying, when you're already making death saves, this doesn't bring you back. Mass polymorph does. It really does not have that limitation.
That qualifier upon it, on it.
Right. True polymorph does, where you permanently turn someone in. It cannot affect a creature with 0 hit points. Mass polymorph can. And so what happens...
Does it specifically mention that it can, or does it just not mention that it can't?
It just does not mention.
I don't know, man. I would feel like because it's in a different book, it's in a different release, that might just be something they forgot to put in.
No.
It's still polymorph.
It says you transform up to 10 creatures of your choice that you can see. An unwilling target must succeed on a wisdom save, and an unwilling shape changer automatically succeeds on the save. And then it just gets right into it. It's... They took that paragraph, and it's the same paragraph ported over.
Huh.
That they did not include that bit. Right? If a target reverts to its normal form when it has no more temporary hit points, or a target reverts to its normal form when it has no more temporary hit points, or it dies, so therefore it's all of a sudden back to making death saves.
Yep.
But if you have failed 2 death saves and I have a 9th level, I have mass polymorph, for whatever reason, bam, you're a frog, get my backpack, we're going to get you to the temple. Right? We're going to get you, we're going to go find 25,000 gold pieces, right? Or the 300 gold pieces worth of diamonds, or whatever it is, so that we can revivify you in a moment. Okay? It's going to keep you from dying. And it's weird. It's weird that it wasn't in there.
What's the... And it's otherwise functions identical as polymorph.
Yeah, you just do it to more people. To 10 creatures.
So
it's a 9th level spell.
What's the CR that you could do with it?
Assume a beast form of your choice. The challenge rating is equal to or less than the target's, or half the target's level if the target doesn't have a challenge rating. So your level...
It's half.
Is half. Yeah. Half your level.
So half your level. So
a horse goes to a regular, like a anything up to a horse's CR rating.
Yeah.
But because players have character levels and not CR, it's half level.
So if you are, it's a 9th level spell, so you are minimum 18th level casting this thing, 17th level casting this thing.
Right, so everybody else around you 17th level as well. Assuming we round down, you can turn anybody into a 8th level beast, specifically beast.
Specifically beast, but...
That's a dinosaur.
That's a dinosaur.
Yeah.
You're like, all right, well, James the Barbarian is unconscious, but now he's a T-Rex. So you're welcome, James.
Yeah. And
right? And also, Lily and...
Yeah, Ron, everyone's a T-Rex.
Hermione, everyone's a T-Rex. So...
Yeah. So, did you just go to Harry Potter?
Yes, I did.
And you didn't pick Harry?
Fuck no, off, Harry's man. The one casting the spell.
Oh, is that what this is in your head?
Yeah.
I hate your head.
I think that's the most insulting thing, and there's been a lot of insulting things you've said to me. That might be the most insulting thing you've ever said to me.
I'm comfortable with it. Anyway, I like this as being just a weird thing that's going to make your DM go, wait, what? And then like pull out their Xanathar and start flipping.
Yeah. This is going to be the one time we tell a player, don't talk to your DM on this one. Surprise them. It'll be fun.
So I like this. That's really fucky. But anyway, that is how you stave off death. Character dies, soul gone, never coming back, death. These are all of the different ways to do it. I think we covered like 40 freaking spells.
Oh, at least.
This is a long episode, but I mean, obviously this is why we didn't put it in the regular episode. But when you are looking for other ways, other creative ways to get healing or to stop death, you don't have to rely on Spare the Dying, Cure Wounds, and Revivify. Those are the 3 that everyone thinks about. There's more out there, and these are your options.
Yeah. And try to have, as we've always said in the podcast and in previous episodes as well, really try to inject a little bit of your own creativity, your own logic into these spells as well. If things like Revivify annoy you, like they do Adam, have other effects. Look into other sources to really boost it and modify these things as you will, so they fit within your campaign world. I am 100% a fan of, yeah, if you're casting Revivify on someone, they're coming back with that -4, and they got to work through it.
Yeah, I mean, look, we could talk about homebrew and healing spells all that we want and the different takes on it, and I think that that's a good topic for another episode in the future. But this episode's gone really long.
Yeah, that's...
and I just want to encourage people to think outside the box. Just because you're a druid or a bard, there's some sorcerer stuff in there. Mm-hmm. And when someone turns to you and says, hey, you know what? We don't have a healer in the party. You can look at them and say, wait until I hit fifth level. Right? There are opportunities in there.
Yeah,
wait until I can just... I will summon a flying snake creature.
Mm-hmm.
And then we will.
Yeah. And this is also above features and stuff like that, which we could have also taken into account, but then it would be a 7-hour episode.
Right.
So.
So anyway, I just want everyone to think about healing and death a little bit differently. When I say in episode 37 that 5th edition is the player's game and not the DM's, that it is damn near impossible to die, this is what I mean. Look at those options. There's some like 280 some odd spells that exist currently in 5th edition, and we just pulled out 40, and that's 1/7 of the spells, help you stave off death.
Yep.
That's insane to me, right? So, anyway, there we go. This has been a special supplemental episode for the It's a Mimic podcast. Again, I've been Adam. You can reach me at Rusty Styrofoam, and with me is Dan.
You can reach me at Oscar_the_orc, and you can reach both of us at itsamimic.com or on Instagram at itsamimic or at on Twitter at itsamimicdnd or on Facebook on the It's a Mimic page.
So let us know if there's anything else that we missed. Besides healing potions and class features, is there another spell out there that you've seen heal or protect someone from dying or to stave it off? What else is out there that we missed? Because I scoured through every spell, every spell, and went hunting through these, taking a look. So I'm wondering if there's anything else out there that we missed. Let us know in any comments, depending on which platform that you're listening to this on, or the go check us out in any of the places Dan just said.
Yeah, for sure.
So thanks very much.
You know what I miss?
What?
I miss Terry.
Why?
I don't know. Stockholm Syndrome, I guess? It's just, it doesn't feel right recording without
her. I have been nicer to you in this episode than... And I hate your head. But I've been nicer to you in this episode than I have been in any other episode ever.
Should we go... let him go and unchain him from the basement?
No, he's happy down there testing out your furniture.
That's right.
Yeah.
He's going to be really mad when he finds out that we recorded an episode while he's tied to a bed.
I think that is his dream. I think his dream is this podcast continuing to move on. And so maybe one day potentially monetizing for him while he is chained to a bed.
Hmm.
That is how he would pass his days.
Well, I'm glad we gave him this gift.
Yeah. Shall we feed him tomorrow?